Last time on Racer TV, the X-Factor GNCC in Peru, Indiana once again offered the riders a challenge, a muddy challenge. After another great start, Walker Fowler was laying chase to a win that meant more than the average. Looking to win here for the first time to finally take home the big X-Factor rack and take home win number 49 to tie Barry Hawk for third in the GNCC ATV all-time wins record. Challenges and conditions proved no match for Fowler, as he would not be denied. Now, today, he looks to take that record one step further and claim historic win number 50. It's the 30th running of the Wiseco John Penton GNCC. Can Walker bring home the big win in Ohio? Stick around. GNCC Live is next.
Welcome to the AMSOIL GNCC Racing Series, presented by Specialized, an AMA national championship. Well, here we are, Landon, Millfield, Ohio, for round number six, the 30th, not the first, not the fifth, not the 10th, the 30th Wiseco John Penton. This is incredible.
Yeah, there's a reason we keep coming back here. I mean, it makes for great racing. It's an awesome track here, and I think we're in for yet again another day of great racing. A little bit about last round.
Yeah.
Walker Fowler came out with another win, but it wasn't easy. Barely got it. I think he got it just a couple miles from the finish there. A couple of the guys were giving him a run for his money, and he really had to work for that one.
Yeah, Bryson Neal finishing second, and then Chris Borich rounding out the box in third. Good to see Walker Fowler finally get that trophy there at the X-Factor. And, of course, last week, the XC2, there was some good action there as well.
Yeah, we actually had a little bit of a mix-up. We had John Glotta Jr. winning his sixth XC2 race in a row now, so he is now still undefeated, I should say. But as far as second and third go, we had some mix-ups. We had Matthew Blankenship in the number two spot and Tanner Walker in the number three spot, first XC2 podium of his career.
Yeah, it was impressive racing last week. And we'll see if we got some more in store for us here this weekend. Again, the 30th Wiseco John Penton. There has been some history made here over the years. Maybe there's some history to be made here today. But first, let's go to Jared Bolton with the Yamaha track description.
Thanks, guys. We're here at the 30th annual John Penton GNCC for this week's Yamaha track description. 30 years of racing, that means there's a ton of history at this event. There's a reason we keep coming back. People love this place. This is a great track. There's a lot of different trails out there, a little something for everybody. There's some really fast sections, there's some really tight sections, there's some technical stuff, and there's some really easy stuff. When you get down in these bottoms, you find these big rocks down in these big creek runs. It gives something for the technical guys to enjoy. Get out in these fast field sections and out here on the Sunday Creek Motocross facility, it gives something for those high speed guys to enjoy. Got a little bit of rain Thursday night into Friday morning. It's going to be a little slick at the beginning of the weekend. Everything wears on. It's going to be a great weekend. I think we're going to see some of the best conditions we've ever seen here at the John Penton. That's this weekend's Yamaha track description. Back to you guys.
Well, thanks, Jared. Now let's take it down to the start line with Rodney Tomlin.
Folks, the stage is set, and I want to say thanks to Mikey and, of course, Landon, as we are here at this 30th running of the Wise Coach John Penton GNCC. And, of course, as we get set to roll through the hills of southeastern Ohio today on this remarkable and historic day, one rider that has lined up on a starting line each and every time that it has happened here in southeastern Ohio at the Russell Family Farm, it is Johnny Gallagher. And, Johnny, we were talking about this earlier. You know, this is the oldest and longest standing GNCC on the circuit, and the amazing thing about this one is you began kind of right here as a youth rider 30 years ago.
Yeah, absolutely. I think this was round four or five of the series back then, and I was on a little 80cc ATV in the youth class and raced here in 1990. So here we are 30 years later back, and I'm still at it and happy to be here.
And I know looking at this one today, these conditions more in the favor of what you like, a little on the sticky side today, huh?
Yeah, you know, that's the one thing about the John Penton GNCC. You just never know what it's going to throw at you. One minute it's slick, next thing you know it's sunny skies and it's packing up. And I wouldn't be at all surprised if we get some rain before this one's over.
I wouldn't be surprised either, Johnny. Well, we wish you well and wish you good luck in your 30th running, my friend.
Thank you. Appreciate it. All the fans at home, we're going to try and put a show for you today.
That's Johnny Gallagher. But let's go ahead now and meet the rest of our starting lineup for this 30th running of the Wise Coach John Penton GNCC. Rolling to the line first today, he rides aboard the number one. He hails from Rogers, Ohio, on a Yamaha GBC Tires Fly Racing DP Brakes backed Yamaha, Walker Fowler. Rolling to the line second today, on board the number three, the rider that has the most wins at six right here at the John Penton GNCC, and the most wins of all time at 75. He hails out of Sunbury, Pennsylvania on a Fly Maxxis Racing Eel Cycle Barn Suzuki, Chris Borridge. Riding aboard the number 521 from Waverly, West Virginia on an Ober Moose Racing Parts Unlimited McGill Mafia backed Honda, Adam McGill. Rolling to the line today, fourth in points, he rides aboard the number four. He's right outside his back door, the Bidwell Bullet from Bidwell, Ohio, on a Lance Mills XC CST Tires Hauser Racing Yamaha, Bryson Neal. Rolling to the line today, fifth in points, he rides aboard the number five from Edinburgh, Pennsylvania, on an Action Off-Road GBC Middlewands DP Yamaha, Cole Richardson. Rolling to the line next, he's sixth in points, aboard the number two from Casca, Pennsylvania, the Maxxis Elka Moose Racing backed Honda, Jared McClure. The 741, seventh in points, hailing from Myersville, Maryland, on a Ryland Johnson Racing GBC Motorsport Shield Cycle Barn Suzuki, Wesley Wolf. Rolling to the line eighth today, aboard the number 12 out of Aurora, Ohio, on a GBC Fly Racing HMF backed Yamaha, Johnny G, Johnny Gallagher. Ranked ninth in points, riding aboard the number nine from Newfield, New York, on a Maxxis Ithaca Recreation Sports WPS Fly Racing Yamaha, Hunter Hart. Rolling to the line next, riding aboard the number 11 from Akron, Ohio, on a B&R Motorsports, GBC Motorsports, Hauser Racing Yamaha, Josh Merritt. And next, the number 406 from Windsor, New York, on an MR Unlimited, GBC Tires, RJR Honda, Devin Feehan. Rolling to the line next, he's the number seven from Richford, New York, the Richford Rocket, they call, on an MCR GBC Motorsports Moose Racing Honda, Marty Christofferson. And welcoming back from Montrose, West Virginia, on a Sturdivant Racing backed Honda, Brent Sturdivant. The 149 rolling up now. Up next, the number 14 from Ithaca, New York, on a Custom Axis Goldspeed Hauser Racing Yamaha, Greg Covert. And last, and certainly not least, riding aboard the number 201 from Carroll, Ohio, on a Pierce Performance Moose Racing 560 Graphics backed Yamaha, Cody Collier. And that, ladies and gentlemen, your starting lineup for this, the Wiseco John Pinton GNCC. And I'll tell you, on top of that, my friends, it is certainly an exciting day as we are, well, on the verge of a couple of different records that may be on the verge of being broken today. And they do include Walker Fowler doing both of those. If he wins today, he will not only strike win number 50 and secure himself as third in the all-time wins record in ATV racing with career win number 50, but he will also take a sixth straight win here at the John Pinton GNCC, which will match what I call and who I call the king of John Pinton right now, Chris Borch, who has six wins here already and again holds that title, the most wins record in this particular race, the longest standing GNCC on the circuit. And folks, we are still waiting for our course marshals, our junior trail bosses, to make their way in so that they can give a course description. But I'll tell you, that just goes to show you the dedication that these guys have. And speaking of dedication, this guy right here, who I believe, are we Facebook Live right now?
Instagram Live.
We are Instagram Live with Eric Kudla, the off-road racing manager at the American Motorcycle Association. And Eric, I tell you, dedication, that's what we're talking about. The track crew out there, they've been out there, well, the last few days getting this place ready to go. And this morning and after last night's rain showers and early morning rain showers, they certainly had a gauntlet laid out for them, but those boys are performing.
Oh, absolutely. Without the hard work of all the people on the course, none of this stuff would be possible. Besides those guys, all of you guys, all of the riders, and everybody here, without everybody working together, none of this stuff would be possible. So it's a huge effort on everybody's part.
And I'll tell you another way it wouldn't be possible if it wasn't for guys like you that are working in Columbus, Ohio, across the nation, across the world, in Washington, D.C., for our rights and freedoms as riders and motorcyclists across the nation.
Yeah, and another thing people don't really think of when they think of the AMA is there's only 55 people of us in the office. The rest of the districts, the clubs, the members, our GRD department, everybody is what really makes the AMA strong. We have thousands and thousands and thousands of members across the entire country, and without our clubs, without our organizers like GNCC and MX Sports and Race Productions and Race and everybody else, none of this would be possible. So it's not just me, it's all of you guys.
Most certainly, and like we said, you guys working for our rights and freedoms, helping control the thing with the rules and being the governing body of what's taking place out here. And what is taking place out here, we got the national championship. You know, this is the premier level as far as AMA racing is concerned, but you know, the GNCC is the pinnacle of it all, but there's so many clubs and organizations around the nation that are putting on events that are grooming youngsters and grooming young men and women to come out here and fight at the nationals for a possible national championship.
Oh, absolutely. Last year I had almost 650 off-road events, just off-road for motor, not counting motocross, not counting road racing, and that's clubs, race organizations, everybody across the whole country, and from 40 all the way as old as 80, as you've seen, some of these people are able to do this their entire lives. And when they retire, they do more, which is be part of clubs, be part of the GRD department, and do whatever they can to better our sport and keep it alive and keep us racing.
And one thing that's going to be able to do that is the fights that we are placing in Washington at the local governments, at the state governments, and like we said, at the national governments. And one of the things that we're fighting, I think we were talking about earlier, is noise ordinances, which really hinge on concerts, but motorcycling and all kinds of things have been thrown in on top of that.
Yeah, and that's what happens a lot of times in government relations is it's something simple like, oh, there's loud concerts. Well, then the shooting ranges get involved. Then the drag strips get involved, and us as racers get involved. I mean, it's not just the loud pipes save lives kind of thing of Harleys and loud motorcycles, but it's just the fact that other people can hear us. And again, we get lumped in with everybody. And so like I mentioned this morning, there's something like that in Ohio going on right now, and we've got people on it already to help fight that. And like you mentioned as well, the action notifications that come from the AMA, when we send you those emails, that's an easy click away. You click, you sign, you get your name on that petition, and those kind of things. When people are saying, you know, oh, we want to make it so concerts aren't so loud, well, and that's just a yes or no vote to them. They don't really care about it, but to us that changes what we do. And so doing simple things like signing a petition and being involved as easily as that make a huge difference.
And one thing that we want to a representative, and find out what they can do, what you can do, and what plans and recourses that you might be able to fix things that might be going awry in your local communities, right?
Absolutely. 1-800-AMA-JOIN, really easy. You can call us, let us know, and we'll be able to direct your call wherever we can.
If you're not an American Motorcyclist Association member, be one. Call that number and join, right?
Absolutely. I'm coming up on 15 years myself because I stopped racing for about 8 years. My mom's a life member. My dad's a life member. My brother's a life member. It's just something that we've always done. So, and I think you guys should too.
There you go. Seems like a good thing. Eric Kudlin, once again, he is the AMA off-road racing manager here for us and helps kind of keep an eye on things and helps guide us and so forth. Again, folks, as we roll into tonight's racing, or today's racing, it seems like it's going to roll into tonight at this rate sometimes. I do want to take this opportunity. This guy's more known on the two-wheel side of things, but Rob Fox from Dunlop Tires is here with us. And, Rob, I tell you, GNCC, it don't matter if it's two wheels, four wheels, it's racing, man. You got to be out here, huh?
Oh, yeah. No, it's only 3 hours for me to my house up north, so I can't miss a GNCC race local here, so I'm just checking out some ATV racing, some quads, even though we don't make the product for you guys anymore, still supporting it and checking it out. So it's always fun to come down here and check everything out.
That's awesome. Now, you guys are here. You still do make the motorcycle tires, and there's a lot of two-wheelers in-house with us, and I know you guys got some pretty big products, and from what I understand, some redefined type stuff, and I think that you guys have been working on.
Yeah, no, we recently just released our MX33 tire, which has been an upgraded version of our MX3S, so it works really well out here for you guys, off-road guys, a little bit more durable, a little bit more performance, so we're always working on new stuff. We have that. We always have our tried and true AT81, which is very popular with you guys, so we got everything from small bikes all the way up to big bikes, whatever you guys need. We're here to help you out. We have special trackside pricing, better pricing this year, and we're always trying to, you know, help you guys out more and more, so make sure you come on by, check us out, see what we got. We take care of you.
Alrighty, sounds good. Rob Fox from Dunlop Tires, accelerate your soul, my friends. And, of course, Casey Greek is here with Impact Solutions. We're talking CST tires. We're talking Elko suspension. We're talking Maxxis tires. We're talking you guys do a little bit of everything just down the road from where we are right now.
Yeah, for sure. We got a little thing of everything going on, kind of like John Ayers. He's kind of in, you know, quite a few different things. My main focus is just making sure the trucks are safe and they get to these events safely, and the drivers have what they need. And then obviously the shock shop with Impact Solutions and Elka. And we're just, you know, putting in the time right now, and I don't even have the trailer here. I'm just here just talking and seeing my riders and acquiring new riders. So that's the focus for me, you know, this week. Snowshoe, I will have the trailer there. I'm gonna be able to come. I had some other things going on, but it worked out so I could be here, and I'm very here.
And we're happy to have you. Casey, good luck to you and all the things that you guys are doing over there at the shop. I know you got some riders out here that you're keeping a very close eye on today.
Definitely. I mean, I got Drew Landers, Bryce Neal, Brandon Owens, Dustin Hendershot, all these guys right now. And I know I'm forgetting someone. You're putting me on the spot a little bit. But, you know, it's just, it's awesome being here and the welcome that anytime when I do get to come to a race and be out with everyone, the welcome that the fans and the people here give all of us is just incredible.
Man, there's a reason why. You guys do a great job. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, that's Casey Greek from Impact Solutions. Just got the official word, sweep is in, so that should technically mean that we still got, now they're telling me 5 more minutes. He's doing a change. Okay. All right, so we're doing a change, and we'll have our riders, our Trek crew, our trail crew in, our what do we call those guys? Junior Trail Boss is in, coming up here in just a few moments. Again, we apologize for the inconvenience. I really thought that we would be on target for this one right here today and not able to make it. Hey, this guy's standing over here underneath my, you're invading my space, so guess what that means? You're going to get to talk to us. And Cody Coy, I've been wanting to talk to you for a long time, and I never get to find you on Pro Row or anything like that. I always see you. Last guy that I announced going on to the starting line. The first question I have, how do you get last pick every time?
Luck of the draw, little chips that you guys make us draw for the whole shot. I always get 20 plus. I got 19, so I was hoping for a better one today. Didn't work out for me, though.
I didn't know if that was by design or what, but regardless, you make it to the line, and that's the important thing. And you've been making it to the line for a long time, since a youth class. And, you know, you don the number 201. A lot of people may not understand why you ride the number 201.
Yeah, when I moved up to the AM race from the youth in that schoolboy senior class, my first year up, I was the first ever person from the schoolboy class to win the 10 a.m. overall for the year and got that 201 plate. And it's just a little chip on my shoulder. It's something I really take pride in, being the first one to ever do that, coming through the ranks, and still the only one to the state to be able to have done that. So it's just a really big deal to me, a really big accomplishment for me in my racing career so far, and just a good motivation for me year to year.
And to keep going, and I'm glad that you keep going. One thing that, we saw you work through the ranks very quickly. You went to college, hey, pro-am, and boom, you're like XC1 like in no time. It seemed like you really didn't have a good chance to really get a good leg on what was going on, but a little while, and things are starting to pull together for you, it looks like.
Yeah, I had a couple bad luck this year. Two wheel issues, lug nuts came off this week, and I wrecked out at Florida and lost half my hyper ring at the last round in X Factor and got stuck because my tire couldn't hold any air. But just learning year to year, race by race, just always trying to pick up on the little things. If I can just get one race to come together, get a good whole shot, come up top five with them guys into the woods, I know I see what they're doing, to be able to mimic what they're doing, to put the pieces together, and I've been real close to the top fives in the past, just right there, just things didn't work out for me, and hoping eventually I'll get something to come together for me.
Like so many of these riders across the XC1 line, and on in general, you're from Ohio. However, this is not your backyard. This is not the kind of conditions you're used to, huh?
No, this is a real, real hard packed here. I'm used to more of like the loamier dirt and like the rockier stuff. I race more towards Chillicothe, Ohio, in the OXCR series where I normally ride, but I travel everywhere. I ride Indiana for all the local series. You go to IXCR, Midwest, New East Coast, and stuff like that in Pennsylvania, so I'm used to all of it, but it's always a lot of fun being here.
Is there something different about the dirt?
It's slick, hard packed, especially with all the rain we've had. It's going to be train track from the tacky dirt on top, and once we hit that solid base, that's why no one's running 22s, even with it being real slick out there. It's just so hard packed and slick.
What are you expecting for yourself out of today?
Just go out and have fun. That's what I do every time. It's all about having fun and seeing what I can do. All these guys out here, we're all so close from that 5th to 10th place range. It could be anyone mix up. The top five guys are just the next tier, and the rest of us are trying to catch up with them guys, hoping to throw it in with them race to race. But 5 through 10, it's always a great battle between us, and just get a good start, put in solid laps, no mistakes.
And that's one thing I think people realize, and we don't cover a lot of that from the announcing standpoint. Obviously, we focus on the front of the pack, but some of the maybe more intense battles that take place throughout a race do take place in that 5th through even 12th or 13th place positions.
Yeah, we have a lot of respect for each other. The rest of the pack have so much respect for each other. We know some people ride better on certain tracks, and some people just have great days, and they'll come up on us. And I'm one of those guys, if you run me down, I'm going to let you go and try to run with you, because I know you caught me. You're obviously running fast, but I'm going to try to pick up on what you're doing. Hopefully we can charge to the front together. So it's always such a good mix-up from the 5th through 10th range. It's always great battling.
I can't wait to see what today brings for you. Welcome back to Ohio. Welcome to home. Even though it's not your home track, it is a home track, but it's not a home track.
It's only an hour from me. I'm a little south of Columbus, so this is the closest one. It's closer than most locals for me. So, this is my home. This is the hometown as it gets.
It's hard to believe how much different the dirt, though, is, though, huh?
Oh, it's so hard packed here, but, low RPMs, keep the tires gripping, and keep on moving.
All right. Well, we'll be looking for that. Watch for the 201. Again, now you know why he runs the 201. He was the first rider to step up from the schoolboy class and win that overall. I think he took that overall championship away from Tracy Pickens that year, if I'm not mistaken, and a few of the others. But pretty interesting stuff, nonetheless, to know a little bit of the history there, as we are making history here in our 30th running of this Wiseco John Penton GNCC. How are we making history? Well, obviously, something's going on out there right now. We wouldn't be on a holding pattern this long if something big wasn't brewing out there. And that's the way that I'm looking at it right now. It's hot. This is the hottest day of the year so far anywhere I've been. 80-some degrees. We're looking at some high humidity. But the beauty of it is this light breeze is keeping things somewhat comfortable here in Ohio. But I've seen a lot of sunburns, and I see a lot of people sweating out here today. Who knows what kind of condition riders are going to be in. I know a lot of riders try to chain for these conditions down in Florida. and the heat and so forth. Riders like, well, Chris Borch being one of those, Walker Fowler being another, as he trains in the middle to south, southern Florida down there. So all these guys are all poised and ready to go. And but the big question is, they may have trained in some heat, but did they train in this kind of heat? And is anybody going to be able to be prepared for this once we get into it? As I was talking with Alex Teagarden from the Landsmill XC team on the two-wheel side of things, he said it's going to be hot out there. He says down in those lower valleys, and there's so many valleys and stuff out here where there's no breeze blowing, he says the air is thick, and it gets a little tougher to breathe and cool off down in those areas. So it'll be interesting to see what this particular race does with these conditions. And not that they're the most extreme conditions we've ever been faced with in GNCC, but they are the most extreme we have been faced with so far here in 2019 as we roll into, the halfway point of this championship season. And that's just hard to believe itself. Seems like only yesterday we were kicking things off. Well, we're supposed to kick things off at the Big Buck, but obviously things went awry with the weather down there on that one, and we didn't get a chance to go. But then we go to Florida, of course, and from that point on, it's certainly been an amazing run for us. We've seen rain, we've seen sunshine, we've seen mud. Came close to some snow maybe one time, but all in all, it's been a great season so far. It's a 13-round series. This is round six. Round seven, when we roll into Tomahawk, will be the midway point, technically, of the championship season. So right here in the heart of 2019, championship points are very valuable. Championship point spreads are, people are starting to take a look at those and see what the realities of their particular classes are and positions in those classes as well. As we got to remind you, we talk a lot about the XC1. We talk a lot about the XC2 Pro-Am class, but we've got a host of other riders that are here with us as well in our amateur classes that are racing behind, racing earlier in the day with our youth racing, our amateur racing at 11 o'clock this morning, our micro racing that we saw this morning. It just builds up to this right here on a Saturday, and we still have one more to go after this. Oh my gosh, they're here. EMTB GNCC will roll on after tonight's race, and then it's EPWE. We'll have details on that coming up. And poor Jared Bolton, buddy, I can see the look on your face. It's been a rough one, but you're ready to go for another 2 hours, I reckon, huh?
I don't know. Does anybody want to ride sweep? Show of hands. No, I didn't think so. Actually, in all honesty, it's getting a whole lot better. It's still, I'm not going to lie to you, it ain't going to be as fun as it could be if it was a lot drier, but it's getting a lot better, and unfortunately, I think the guys tomorrow are going to have a better time than you guys. I kind of hate to say that to you, but honestly, it's really rutted. It's a little slick in places, but the good news is like it's getting to the point now where everything's makeable. So you're going to take off from the start here, work your way around. Got a little hill climb there across the road. Fast section will take you across the top of that ridge, drop back down. Good double track trail. Drop a little short field crossing there. That'll take you out to the 3 mile mark. Right there, right before you ever get to that 3 mile mark, you guys are going to jump off on a section that hasn't been run this weekend. I'd say part of it will be a little greasy, but most of it's actually really good. That'll bring you back around up past the 3 mile mark, come down a little downhill out the bottom there. It's really rutty through there. Pick your lines. You won't have any trouble with it. Keep your momentum. You guys should all know this. You guys you're all pro A and B riders, so you guys shouldn't have any trouble with this stuff. That'll take you out to the 4 mile mark. Good stuff there. It's a slot car track. I used to like playing with slot car track, and I felt like I was just riding one. Slot car track around to the 5 mile mark. After that, it gets a little bit better there. A couple of little ups and downs that are pretty fun. One little rocky creek crossing that'll bring you back around. Nothing too major through there. That'll bring you all the way over to the 6 mile mark where you're running this long benched out trail. You're going to get from the 6 to the 7 kind of quick. There's a section out there that we ended up cutting out for you guys. The hill out in it, it's got a great big rock in it, and it's just way, way too slick for you guys. So you're going to get from the 6 to the 7 kind of quick. No worries there. If it feels like it's only a half mile, that's because it's only a half mile. So that'll run you back around. Good flowing trail back and forth. Short little field section. And when you jump back in the woods, you're going to go to that point. Nice, easy uphill. Use your momentum, climb right to the top of the hill, drop down the other side. You'll come back out to the track side pitting over the 8 mile mark, drop back in the woods again. Got another little rock section uphill, bring you back into track side pitting once again. And then you guys can work your way around to the 9 mile mark. When you get to the 9 mile mark, you're banging an immediate left, dropping downhill down into this creek run. Good rocky creek run, good technical stuff. You guys that have raced here before, you've probably done it every year you've been here. It's a lot of really good stuff down there. That'll bring you over to a quick little hill climb, back up, good flowing trail back and forth all the way to the 10-mile mark, and then you're going field, woods, field, woods, field, woods, all the way to the finish, to the 11-mile mark, run out and around the motocross track, through the finish, come back out, out and around the pro pits, and you're going to come back over the hill here, come back across this road to the 1-mile mark, and you guys got this big grass track, one little section of woods over here, back behind the start here, bring you to the 2-mile mark and back to where you started at. So you guys, we changed a few little things here and there and took a couple of little things out. I'm still going to call it about 10.8 miles, so we really didn't shorten you up that much, just about a half mile or so. So it's a lot of good stuff out there, and there's a lot of stuff that's just kind of okay. But best of luck to you guys. Stay safe, have fun, and pay attention to those arrows, everybody, even though they got mud on them.
All righty. Thanks a lot, Jared Bolton. And, of course, want to remind everyone, safety first. GNCC Racing, like all motorsports, can be dangerous. Racers, now that you've had an opportunity to inspect the course, have heard the race procedures and a description of the course, if you feel that either you or your machine is not prepared, then now is the time for you to withdraw for complete refund of your entry fee, no questions asked. Remember, it is your responsibility to operate your machine in a safe manner, maintaining control at all times. Extreme caution is required when approaching areas with high concentrations of fans. Do not take unnecessary risks that endanger the safety of fans. You will be penalized for reckless racing. Race fans, due to the nature of GNCC racing, there is no fence barrier around the course. It is your responsibility to keep yourself and your children a safe distance from the race course. Never turn your back on oncoming racers, and remember, stay off the racetrack. And finally, for the safety of everyone, unauthorized drones are prohibited at GNCC and will be confiscated. All right, now I want to listen up. All you folks down here at the end of turn two, with your back to the racetrack, and I want you to pay particular and close attention. They're going to be coming burning in hot into that second turn. I don't want them blowing through the banners and taking you out, so pay attention to what's going on in case something like that would happen. We got a good buffer zone, but we don't want to take any unnecessary chances. And with that, Ricky Towery says, fire them up. We're about a minute, 2 minutes away from going GNCC racing, my friends. And again, for those of you that have joined us along the World Wide Web, at GNCC Live on RacerTV.com and through Facebook, and all of our partners, of course, we welcome you to Millfield, Ohio, for finally the running of the Whitesco John Pitt and GNCC Pro ATV afternoon racing event. Conditions warranting a long race. We had an 8 o'clock youth race this morning. It went long. We had two micro races that went long this morning. We got started way late on our 11 o'clock race afternoon. And then, obviously, it took a little extra time to sweep the course and get it prepared for this afternoon's race. So we are some two hours past our original start time. Folks, it is 4:03 right now. We should be seeing checker flags wave right now, but we are just now about to see the green flag wave. Does that not tell you this is going to be a big and monumental GNCC, my friends? I think when things build like this, things are going to happen and things could change. 1 minute, 1 minute before this round number six, as Ricky Towery signals these riders and gets them ready for today's. So like we said, 30 years we celebrate here, and we know something big is a-brewing with a 2 hour late start. Shut them down, guys. Shut them down. Shut them down. Shut them down. We are now less than 30 seconds away from going GNCC racing here in southeastern Ohio. And I got to ask you, Ohio, are you ready to go GNCC racing? I'm a little disappointed. I'm not going to lie. This is Ohio, and I expected so, so much more out of these race fans. I know you want to see ask you one more time. Ohio, are you ready to go to GNCC Racing? 10 seconds. And row number one, the XC1 Pro, will be off and rolling at the Weisco John Penton GNCC. Around the first turn, $250 up for grabs, and it's the 406 Devin Feehan taking the whole shot. Feehan here with us on the MR Unlimited GBC Tires RJR back machine, and he's got a host of riders behind him. XC2 Pro-Am, Roland X, Drew Landers, Tanner Walker, Brody Livingood, Steve Cooper, Jordan Pavlaski, Matt Blankenship, Charles Dunn, Kenny Schick, Ben Kowalewski, Nick Royalty, Jay Shadron, Wyatt Wilkin, John Glotta, Ronnie Rush, and Buddy Lambrow ready to roll with it. Another clean start, and it's going to be the 7-14 of Ronnie Rush from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania on a Tele Energy Kenda PDP backed machine. College Chase, 16-21, Seth William, Alan Daniels, Andrew Bainofsky, Logan Weishire, Tyler Swindle, William Lavelle, also Peyton Dalton, Brandon Owens, Chase Petro, Hayden Nicholson, Noah Mickelson, Noah Gingler, Chase Allison, Gavin Jenkins. Less than 10 seconds to go for Levi Joy, Chase Denny, Dylan Walrake, Red Cox, Corey Vandeliner, Hunter Schreiber, Casey Simmons, Cameron Avey, and Mikey Nichols. See if we get this early lead in this College A class. The number 400, Noah Mickelson from Salisbury, North Carolina, a red rider on a Phoenix Racing Factory Honda team. College A being led by the Factory Honda boys. Started out today, Junior A 22-plus class. Coming up next, Levi Cohen, Josh Haney, Justin Miller, Luke Shepard, Tyler Palmer, Jake Millwood, Zachary Phillips, also Bruce Weiland, Nick Davidson. 10 seconds. Alex Elioff, Nathan Owens, Jed Claypool, J.D. Brown, Ben Danner, Justin Collins, Michael McAvoy, Chad Burner, or Chandler Burner, Andrew Hickson, and Jeremy Ladon. And it is the 31 of Levi Cohen, literally right out his back door, probably 250 yards from his driveway to the entrance to the Millfield track here at Sunday Creek Raceway. He pulls the early lead at a 30-plus class. Big Papa Pete, Jeff Pickens, Chris Conklin, Todd Muscala, also James Green, Dirk DeCesar, Jeremy Gouchard. 10 seconds. Kevin Yoho, Jay Turner, Dustin Hinnichuk, Michael Brad Whitehead, and Kenneth Kelly. It's the 21, Big Papa P out of Shamokin, Pennsylvania. BC Motorsports, Waynesburg, Yamaha, Fly Racing Machine. Sounds of Thomas Barrett, Wesley Stone, Brad Macri, Mark Patson. All ready to roll with 10 seconds. Off and rolling. The legends out front early on, and that is the three. A28, Brian Ranch, right, Harrisville, Pennsylvania. And seconds. Jared Kemp, Grayson Ella, Braylon Secure. Nicholas Watson, Ethan. Aaron Greenwald. Brian Williams, Hunter Gotze, Tyler Rupke, Brian Goetz. And it's the 171, another red rider. That is another Phoenix Honda ride in its College B class. Grayson Eller taking the this one, along with Hunter Gotze, Tyler Rupke, Brandon Goetz, Michael Orvello, Caden Ryan, and Keegan Walker. College B off and rolling now. Junior B in 10 seconds. seconds. Ryan Macy, Curtis Tarman, Stephen Martin, Justin Eisen, Cody Fair, Jacob Allball, Dylan Holloway, Hitchum, Travis McConaughey, Brant Barna, Cameron Klein, and Van Hanlon. Cameron Klein from Mammoth, West Virginia, at the Reese Racing Home Cycle Court. Miller Nathan, shot Brandon Romito, La Plate, Rod Bolin also out here in this one, along with Chris Landefield, Corey Tribalock, Tribalcock, Keith Stewart, Cody Holcomb, Dave Ashby, Wesley Smith, David Pichet, Frederick LaFelle, Cody Stewart, John Higgins, all ready to roll in this Vet B 30 plus class in a matter of only 10 hours waiting for this second turn to be cleared. It looks like we got one stalled out. His fire ready to go, and he says, all right, let's go. 10 seconds. Oh, here we go. That B 30 plus class rounding the first turn now. Ooh. Wesley Smith from Steubenville, Ohio, Honor Flight Network, Honda East Toledo, and LS4 Back Drive. Senior B 40 plus class, Greg Phillips, Jason Flaviano, Dan Dakota, Jason Limley, Charles Blackman, Nick Lembruno, Robert Stevens, and Jeff Harvey.
10 seconds.
And Senior B off and rolling, and that's our final start of ATVs this afternoon. We'll have EMTVs coming up in a little bit, but right now, the start of this two-hour race and being led in this last class by the 353 of Jason Flaviano out of Girard, Ohio. Wrapping up here as far as the start are concerned, my friend, and we'll be heading over to, well, near the finish line and all through this race course. So we'll head over and see Mikey Williams and the rest of the folks coming up here in just a few moments when GNCC Live continues after this.
It's the thrill of victory, the agony of defeat. It would seem difficult for someone to want to sign up for a task like running to 2 or 3 hours through the woods in some of the toughest conditions around. That's what GNCC Racing is all about. Stay tuned with us, RacerTV.com, with more GNCC Live.
Consistent clutch fuel is vital to effective starts or to confidently maneuver around obstacles on the trail. AMSOIL synthetic dirt bike oil was subjected to an extreme simulated start test. After 32 simulated race starts, AMSOIL synthetic dirt bike oil continued to deliver consistent clutch fuel, and the clutch plates remain clean with no visible wear. The competitor's oil, however, allowed discoloration and significant wear after just 16 starts. AMSOIL synthetic dirt bike oil. Give your bike the protection it needs.
What is your passion? Hitting the perfect line? Finding the perfect trail? Routing the perfect adventure? Or just living and breathing the moto life? Do you feel pride for a job well done after tackling a late night in the shop? Do you enjoy time spent with friends and family in the great outdoors? Spanning over three decades, one name has taken the lead for supplying the best power sport parts, accessories, and apparel to fuel your passion. One name that knows it goes beyond getting you the best prices, quickest shipping, or largest selection. One name that builds and innovates for our industry. One name that teaches, helps, and supports our fellow riders, racers, and organizations. We are Rocky Mountain ATV MC. We have transformed a team of moto enthusiasts into a powerful teaching team to ensure that you make the best purchasing decision with your hard-earned cash. We build communities with fellow riders to provide you with all you need to make a good decision. See customer photos, reviews, Q&As, and more while you're on our easy-to-use website. Need help fast? Live chat with our specialists, email, or drop us a line. Visit us today and experience the best in OEM and aftermarket parts, accessories, apparel, and industry-leading information. We offer lightning-quick shipping, free on orders over $75, a huge inventory, free apparel exchanges both ways, and customer service that leaves all others behind. Experience one name that leads all others. Rocky Mountain ATV MC. Get ready.
Speed has its price. Fortunately, it's super affordable. The Specialized Speed into Spring Sale with up to 40% off March 15th through 31st. The faster you visit your local Specialized dealer, the faster you ride. The all-new Yamaha Wolverine X2. With a compact chassis, perfect for exploring tight technical terrain. An ultra-quiet and smooth 850-class twin-cylinder engine. And next-level versatility with a 600-pound dumping cargo bed. No other side-by-side delivers this level of proven off-road performance. The all-new Wolverine X2 from Yamaha.
Born of family values and a homegrown work ethic, Kometic Gaskets seals your machine so you can focus on the finish line. Kometic Gaskets are the competitive standard for racers who demand the very best. Kometic Gaskets are constructed from superior materials designed to perform in the most demanding environment. Whether it's championships on the line or a day in the dirt with friends, professionals and enthusiasts depend on Kometic. Kometic Gaskets, sealing championships since 1989.
This Racer TV broadcast is brought to you by Amsoil, the first in synthetics. Specialized Turbo e-bikes, it's you, only faster. And by Rocky Mountain ATV MC. Get ready.
And welcome back to GNCC Live. I'm Mikey Waynes. You guys have already heard from my colleague, Rodney Tomlin. And Landon Wolf will be joining us in the booth here momentarily for the little play-by-play commentating action. How about that start? Well, here we are. The Wiseco John Penton, not just the Wiseco John Penton, doggone it. No. The 30th annual Wiseco John Penton. Can you believe that? Round number six of this AMSOIL GNCC Racing Series presented by Specialized. Unbelievable. 30 years we've been coming here. Absolutely some historic moments. And we got a great track lined up for you today. Taking a look at the Yamaha Racing track map. As you can see, about an 11.3-mile course for you guys here this afternoon. Bit of a late start for us, obviously. But that's all right. We're off and rolling. And as you look at the track, you can see if you've ever been to the John Penton, you know it's got a little bit of everything to offer. The white dots on your screen right now, those indicate shots where we have got the standalone camera shots. And then the black rectangular box there, that is going to be all of our drone footage that we have for you here this afternoon at the Wiseco John Penton. So great track in store for you. You guys probably heard Jared Bolton talking about that. And speaking of it being our 30th annual Wiseco John Penton, we had a chance to catch up with some of the XC1 riders about their favorite memory here at the Wiseco John Penton over the years.
So my best memory actually would be 2003. Got out front, pulled a pretty decent sized lead. It was pouring rain, just buckets and buckets of rain. I think at one point I had a several minute lead. Unfortunately, I decided I didn't need goggles, tried to go without them, scratched both corneas, left here not being able to see. And I wouldn't say that it was my best memory, but it's definitely the most memorable, throwing away what should have been an easy win by just being stubborn and not stopping for goggles.
Yeah, actually definitely. You know, racing best in 4 years. I think the second year I raced here was in 2016 was my first amateur overall win, which was, you know, really special to me. I had won the class, but this was the race I finally got the overall for the amateurs. Yeah, Johnny's raced every race, so, I mean, he definitely should know every inch of this track. I mean, I can't even comprehend that amount of time. I'm only 19, so.
This is our 30th time here at the John Petten GNCC. Thinking back over the years, what is Chris Borch's favorite memory here at the John Petten?
Oh, we've been here a long time as well. It's not been 30 years like Johnny G, but we've been coming here a while, and there's nothing really that sticks out. It's just an awesome facility, great place, great passing, just an all-around good track. So we're looking forward to it tomorrow, and hopefully get up front and see if we can get another win this year.
Mine was over in the field in the tall grass, where we start, because I've had a lot of memorable races over here. You know, it was this is one place where I was able to put my name on the map. I got my first podium here from the Pro-Am Road, dang near won the race. We missed it by, I think it was like 20-some seconds, if that. But, you know, John Petten definitely holds a special place in my heart, other than the fact that my wife comes from Ohio. And it does, you know, it does have some pretty good racing over here. Whether the weather conditions be perfect or they be a little wet like we have now, it always makes for good racing. So, yeah, John Petten is always one of them places that that we like to come to.
So there you go, guys, getting the word from some of our XC1 guys there. And how about that start for Devin Feehan there? And how about the shots, him and Chris Borch taking it Johnny G? Haven't raced as many as Johnny, but, yeah, Johnny's been to all of them. How about that, all 30 of them? So taking a look at our riders coming through this wood section here. And you can see some of the conditions. You may not have picked it up on the start, but we had a delay today, obviously, and that was due to some of the weather that we didn't have today, but some of the weather we've had over the last week's time, and then we had some more rain last night. This mud here in Ohio, it's like glue. It sticks to the bottom of the of your shoes, let alone you're out there racing. It sticks to your machine. It sticks to your boots. It's just another added element. This is as hardcore GNCC as it gets. And you can see some of the different lines these guys are able to choose out there through this section. This is just a small example. So anywhere that's covered by shade is still going to be a sloppy, sloppy mess. I mean, you take a look right there at the FMF PowerPoint, and these guys working their way through this section. Our XC1 guys there. It looked like Devin Feehan is still out in front. It looked like we had Walker Fowler in the number four spot. And that was Chris Borch right behind him. So these guys all still very close together in a bit of a cluster here. So we'll see how this one plays out. As you can see, the rest of our XC1 pack working their way through. So we should be getting into the XC2 guys here in just a second. But, yeah, so how about the start for Devin Feehan? He gets the whole shot out of the XC1, and he's hard on the throttle out in front. It's been a pretty good season for Devin so far. He had, I believe, the injury early on. So he's back out there and rolling. And there goes, I believe that was Johnny Gallagher on screen there going up through the FMF PowerPoint out here for his 30th John Petten GNCC. So again, just a little bit more than an 11-mile track for these guys today. Seen some gnarly racing here this morning in both the youth race, the AM race with the 4x4s and WXC, and we saw some crazy racing in the micros as well. Those poor guys might have had it the roughest, but this has been a very, very difficult track, and we've seen a lot of big changes. Big leads have just gone to nothing in just a matter of just a couple of laps here, so it should make for some interesting racing here today. Of course, Walker Fowler chasing after some history. Certainly has his work cut out for him now as he starts back in the number, looks like number four position back there, as more of our XC2 guys now working their way up in here into the FMF PowerPoint. Ronnie Rush with a great start to today's race. He took the whole shot, and I believe that was he was up there a little way. So we'll get a better idea of just how far apart these riders are in the XC1 and XC2 class as they check into the finish line as they're coursing through one of the last wood sections over there now. So we'll get our time on that, see what separation looks like. But again, I believe Chris Borch has got the most wins here all time at the John Petten with six on the ATV side of things. And I believe Walker Fowler's got five coming into today. So that's the big story as these guys work their way through the Monster Mile. Working their way through the Monster Mile there. So there goes Chris Borch. Or no, that was not Chris Borch. That might have been, was that Bryson Neal? My screen's a little blurry here. So that was Bryson Neal. So Bryson in the lead, is that what? So no one was in front of him. We didn't miss anybody. Is that the way I'm understanding that? Okay, so it sounds like we got Bryson Neal out in front now as he works his way through the Monster Mile. So that may have been him out in front of Devin Feehan when they were going through the FMF PowerPoint too. So need to be able to almost get a look at the back of these guys. There we go. There goes Adam McGill up in through the Monster Mile. Cheering him on. Cody Collier checks in, or doesn't check in, but moves through there. More of our riders coming through. So, yeah, getting a good look. Our XC1 guys moving through the Monster Mile here to wire the XC2 guys should be making their way through here in just a moment. But, again, talking to the history that we've had here, there's a different line through the Monster Mile right there. So a lot of that's one of the big things we heard this morning from the AM race was a lot of line choices out here at the John Penton. So makes for some pretty interesting racing. So certainly got to play into the strategy as this one rolls on here this afternoon. And, well, honestly, into the evening. We always say afternoon, but this one's going to go into the evening hours. So you can see that Monster Mile, we always say it may not be a full mile, but doggone it, it's going to feel like it. We guarantee it. And that one is certainly getting the best of some of them out there. So how about that? So getting into some of the XC2 guys now. Checking in through the Monster Mile, and pretty good racing so far, pretty clean. All of our guys, you can see they're still right there in that cluster, one right after another. Nobody's really getting much separation in between them after lap number one. Like I said, we'll get an idea of some of these gaps. I mean, I got to think most of them are less than a second between each rider, but no huge gaps like we see a lot of guys. Walker been known to jump out in front, try to run away with it early. Not going to be the case today. He's got at least... Last we saw at least three riders in front of him, so he's going to have his work cut out for him. And we'll see how it plays out. Certainly so much history here, and you got to think there's just something in the air, something about today that kind of indicates maybe this one's going to be one of those special ones we're talking about for years to come. The 30th John Penton GNCC is joined back in the booth by Rodney Tomlin, who got you guys going down there on the start line. And Rodney, we're off to a pretty good start. Ronnie Rush getting the whole shot in the XC1. Or excuse me, Devin Feehan getting the whole shot. I'm jumping ahead. Ronnie Rush was XC2, got the whole shot. But it looks like we've got Bryson Neal out in front of the pack now. Walker's back in the number four position. So things are mixed up. But these guys, I mean, they're right there tight within one another. And honestly, for a track that from this morning, we saw a lot of huge gaps, a lot of different line choices for these guys. I'm a little surprised that it's as close this early as it is.
Well, you know, after listening and, well, today, I mean, this is not your necessarily traditional GNCC. And the odd thing about this is it's not raining. And,
yeah.
And take note of that. It rained last night overnight, and it hasn't rained since early this morning, so to speak. And the conditions don't look necessarily the worst. And we've had a lot worse muddy conditions, but I don't ever recognize a time that we've ever had these types of long sweeps. And I just heard on the radio on the way over, Jared Bolton, junior trail boss, one of our junior trail bosses said, "Oh, they're at it again down here, just past the 4 mile marker. They're everywhere." So evidently, somewhere around the 4 mile marker, there's something that is just kind of discombobulating things in all the races today so far. We've seen that happen, and you know, whenever you come to this Ohio mud and get into this terrain, sometimes you just got to face the fact that you've got challenges, and that's what we've got here today. And as we pointed out, you pointed out, I've talked about it, this is the 30th, something big's happening.
Yeah,
we've never been 2 hours late to start a race here at John Penton that I can recognize and remember anyway.
It is unbelievable. I know the folks at home were chomping at the bit, itching for this to get going. Trust me, we were here as well. We were ready for this thing to get rolling. So as we're still in lap number one, I believe we're going to take a look now at least the XC1 and XC2 starts.
A
Love the fact we've had some good clean starts lately. No early starts. Everybody getting a good jump off the line. Walker Fowler, man, blast through that first turn, but he was going so hard and so fast, he couldn't slow down. Devin Feehan threaded needles there and crosses that whole shot line stripe first and earns himself $250. He also leads the pack through the first part of this race course as well. And this has got to be the strongest and best start I've seen out of Devin Feehan. And being off the last couple of races due to injury, he had a scapula problem.
Yeah.
This right here is good for him. It's good energy, I think, to carry him through today and as well into the next few rounds. Up next, our XC2 class, another highly competitive class. And these starts, Mikey Wayne's, are unbelievably crazy when they go into that first turn. Everyone wants a piece of, well, the first place. They want that hole shot credit. And not only that, they want to gain that early lead, but it was all Ronnie Rush today. He got to that first turn first. He got to the second turn first, and he laid it down. Everyone else laid chase behind him, and they're trying to get that all sorted out. Not sure where he's at right now, where he stands, but I got to tell you, this is going to be a good battle between these guys today. All these XC2 guys are hungry. We've got about five or six guys that could literally take a win on any given day, and every one of them are chomping at the bit right now, trying to put themselves in that exact position. Down on Pro Row right now, the VP Fuels Pro Row is looks like we're at the Feehan pits as they are watching over on this motocross track, actually, over near the finish line. So looks like we got some riders starting to check in, Mikey Wayne.
Yeah, we've got our top eight in. It looks like Cole Richardson. How about that? The Yamaha Cole Richardson out in front. He's got a 9.5-second lead over the 406 of Devin Feehan. So strong, strong start for both of those guys. And then how about this? The 741 of Wesley Wolf in the number three spot. And that's awesome. Hearing him talk to Rodney this morning, he's just having fun. He said,
yeah.
How I do is how I do. Is what it is.
You know, he used to be very serious a handful of years ago when he first started AMA Pro ATV Racing and GNCC. But like everyone else, you know, I mean, time takes its toll on the pocketbook, and he has to work hard to get to where he's at. And that's what he does. He goes out and he has fun. He was in Hamer, South Carolina, south of the border for the ATV Motocross National last week. Said he didn't have the best of weekends, but look here. He backs it up with a great start.
It.
That's him going through right there, was it not? There.
That, correct. Yeah, that was Devin Feehan rolling through. And that looked like, you know what? I'm starting to think that Bryson Neal did not score when he came through. Because I'm not showing Bryson, and I'm almost positive that was Bryson that rolled through Pro Row in the number three spot. So we may have Bryson Neal, because he's as I'm looking down through the scoring, I don't think he's checked in. So maybe Bryson's had some transponder issues, perhaps.
Oh, doggone, I didn't even realize Coltrane was out front.
Yeah.
You know, you heard me make it mention earlier today, I said, during Pro Row interviews, I said, well, there's Coltrane. He's just making his way back in. We're at the end of it. I said, I tell you what, we're just going to let it go today because normally when we talk to him, he has an off day, so we'll see what happens here today. Look at this. Cole Richardson, the Coltrane, out front. Devin Feehan in second. Wesley Wolf is in third. Chris Borich in fourth. And right behind him, Walker Fowler in the number five spot. Now, as far as deficits go, we're only looking at 10 seconds between first and second. Another 12 back to Wesley Wolf in third. Another 10. So we're looking at 30 to 35 seconds. Walker Fowler seeing himself down now out of first place back in that number five position. There is your leaders. And there is Cole Richardson, the Cole train, making things happen out there on the number five machine. And again, I'm not seeing the number four.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I'm pretty sure that Bryson Neal's out there. Let's take a look. That might have been him right there.
Yeah.
I think that was Bryson Neal out in front there. And this is the mulch pile, isn't it?
I believe it is.
Yeah, which gets – okay, that is the mulch pile they're going through right there. And that thing, if you've ever watched a John Pitt and GNCC, by the end of the day – that thing gets gnarly. That's one of those difference maker sections of the track.
Yeah, there's option lines in it this year, too. As you notice, everyone's going to the outside, but there is an inside option line that is a little bit shorter, but it's also a lot more challenging. They went in, and actually, you see those whoops and stuff. They developed early whoops and actually established those. If you're going to go this way, it's going to be more of a challenge for you.
Goodness gracious.
Wow.
Go ahead.
Yeah, I'm just going to say, trying to get this. So we got Bryson Neal in fourth. Now, that makes sense now because I thought I saw him go through fourth place And I think he was passing into second place when we saw him there just a moment ago. We got problems going on here. Who's this? It's so hard to tell these numbers right now.
Can't see.
Is that the 201? I believe that might have been Cody Collier.
That's Cody Collier.
We were talking with Collier before the start of the race. He's all the way back in 15th place position to kick things off here today.
So I got to think Cody Collier is going to take that outside line next time he hits that mulch pile, getting the best of him right there.
Well, as we take a look at the way things are breaking down right now, we do have a Junior B22 Plus class rider that has checked in with a 24 minute and 10 second lap time. That is a full minute faster than Cole Richards and Ryan Mazzella. Now you say, that's not possible. And it may not be, but you know, you look at the lap times, that is kind of possible, because remember, even though these guys are going, the first lap for these pro riders is not their fastest lap, so they could be laying back a little bit. So we're going to go under the assumption that Ryan Mazzella from Girard, Ohio, in the Junior B 22 Plus class, unofficially leading the overall. But I got to tell you, we heard that there was some bottlenecks, yeah, some issues, so that right there might be part of that as well. Don't expect that to be and maintain that position if that is the case. But we will keep an eye on that just in case. Hey, that's what this is all designed for. That's
exactly
what all the times are zeroed out on days like today. Remember what we said, big things
for sure
can happen. What would you think if a B-rider actually
who's in
won?
The pits here?
Who's this?
Is this?
That's a 969.
I think it's one of our.
That's actually Brody. Yeah, Brody Lamoureux out of Windsor, New York. He's an XC2 rider. Let's see where he actually happens to be sitting right now as far as the standings in his class. Brody, wow, checking in 10th place. And look, I mean, other than the first place gap of 41 seconds and
wow,
another gap of 44 seconds out there, these guys are all pretty nose to tail out there, but with gaps of 2 to 8 seconds for the majority of the class out there, it looks like, on this first lap of XC2 Pro-Am class racing. Now, just to give you a heads up, Ronnie Rush has checked in the number one spot of the XC2 Pro-Am class. I believe he is currently in a 10th place overall. We'll go back and check in with that in a minute. John Glotta Jr. running in second, 41 seconds back, less than a second behind him. Drew Landers on the 17. Ben Kowalewski in fourth out of Green Bend, Pennsylvania. He's riding the 219, 127. Matt Blankenship, last year's College A winner out of Greenwood, Indiana, is fifth. Then Jordan Paplatsky in sixth. Wyatt Wilkin in seventh. Steve Covert is eighth. Ninth, Jay Shadron. And Bodie Lamoureux, whom we saw in the pits there just a moment ago, rounds out your top 10 in the XC2 Pro-Am class. Now back up to our overall standings. All right, well, let's go ahead. Let's check in with that College A class right now. We know what the XC1 class is shaping up like. Let's go with the College A class. Right now we've got Brandon Owens out of Walker, West Virginia, that has checked in that number one position. We have Seth Wilson, the 26, out of Smithville, Pennsylvania, in second. And then, believe it or not, I didn't realize, but I've got this connection with this guy. Jackson, Ohio's Jace Denny is running in the number three spot. And we've seen Jace actually performing quite well in this College A class on a few different occasions so far here in 2019. Good to see him at his home race, about an hour from his back door, right here at Millfield. Jace Denny running in the number three spot. Hayden Nicholson, the 335. Whom we saw, or 355, he's, I believe, got 400 on his
look
quad.
On the screen here, Rodney. This is something the one consistent thing I heard on the podium all morning was bottleneck, bottleneck, bottleneck. And I got to think, at some point today, this is probably going to affect this pro race.
Oh, most definitely, and we'll see it definitely doing that. Hayden Nicholson is right. That's Hayden Nicholson, not Noah Mickelson, who got the whole shot. Don't know where
Very
Noah
close.
Mickelson. Yeah. Hayden Nicholson in fourth. Levi Joy rounds out your top five. So far, that's all. We got Peyton Delton in now, the 223, out of Morgantown, West Virginia, in sixth. And looks like some Vet A riders are starting to check in. Let's check in with that Junior A class now. Jeremy LaDon leading that Junior A class, 38 seconds. In second place is Alex Elliott. In the third place position, the 531 of Michael McAvoy and Jed Claypool rounds out your top four in this class. Mikey, I know looking at these classes, they're just a handful of the riders coming in. But look at that Vet A class right there.
Yeah, taking a look at the Vet A, your first place rider, Jeremy Gushard, out in front. Big lead for him, 50 seconds right now. The 275 of James Green is in the number two spot on the Honda. And then Kevin Yoho, the 542. A lot of these Vet A guys end up being, that is a stacked class. A lot of these guys end up being our top overall amateurs when it's all said and done. Kevin Yoho in the number three spot, the 542 machine, and Michael Lancaster rounding out your top four. And then the senior A 40 plus, Thomas Barrett, out in front on the 451 Honda. Got about, how about that? Half a second lead over the 828 of Brian Shaw. John Sousa in the number three position with Dale Batson in fourth. Mark Batson out of Michigan. I got to think they're brothers, would be my guess. Both out of Michigan in the number five spot with Robert Eschen in six and Wesley Stone rounding out your top seven. And then taking a look at the B class is now the College B. Out of the College B class, Grayson Eller out in front. It's here. Aaron Greenwell in the number two spot with Corey Miller in third. Hunter Godsey is in the number four spot. I looked at the screen for a second, saw him zooming in on that monster mile, wondering what in the heck happened there. Corey Miller in third, Hunter Godsey fourth, Cale Klein in the number four position in that College B class with Cade Olexo in sixth, and Ethan Meyer rounding out your top seven riders there in the College B class. And still waiting on a lot of these B classes to check in for lap number one yet. That might be the only one so far. Wanted to give some of those amateur classes a shout out. They're working their tails off, right? Give them a shout. Yeah, so those guys are pretty much it right now. So you are looking on screen at the Monster Mile. Cole Richardson leading after one. He has got, not the biggest gap, but one of the biggest gaps out there, which is still not saying much for 10 seconds. He's out in front of the 406 at Devin Feehan. Who's in the number two spot, who took the hole shot off of the start. Bryson Neal, who may be having some transponder issues. We'll find out more when they pass through on lap number two. But Bryson Neal in the number three position with Wesley Wolf, WW, and fourth. Fifth place is Chris Borich. Walker Fowler in the number six spot. Sneaky Snake, Cobra himself, Jared McClure in seventh. Hunter Hart, eighth. Adam McGill, the 521 machine, is in the number nine position. And Ronnie Rush rounding out your top 10 in the overall. And, of course, Ronnie Rush is out of that XC2 class in the number one spot in class. So you can see that drone shot creates, it sort of paints the picture of what we've got here. We may get to the end of this race, and these guys might be kicking up dust. I don't know. I didn't think that was a possibility two weekends ago at the X Factor, and I'm watching it from home, the bike race, I guess, on Sunday, and those guys are kicking up dust at X Factor.
That was nuts, wasn't it?
I couldn't believe it. I'm sitting there watching Racer TV. I'm like, I need to check on Rodney, see how these guys are doing. And I'm like, it's a complete mud fest, and I'm watching, and
the
trucks are going by, and they're kicking dust up.
Yeah, but that was very deceiving, I gotta
tell
you.
Well, that's for sure. There was very small sections, but.
Can I say, I love the design of your new Racer TV shirt.
They're very nice, right?
Yeah, the mud splatter.
The mud, yeah. I got roosted pretty hard this morning.
Wow.
My own fault, but it's nice to be an honorary mud fleet.
Well, honorary, unexpected. But you know what? When you come to a race like that, like this is what you can expect. Again, big things happening, and the big thing right now, I'm so sweaty. And it's a hot. I'm trying to wipe my glasses off, and all I'm doing is smearing
it. Yep.
Yeah, so I can't see anything right now. The computer screen, the TV screen. So you got your young eyes. Keep an eye on what's going on. Give me about a minute, and I'll be right back with you, brother.
Yeah, money. We're good. Yeah, it's definitely muggy in Ohio. It's that sticky Midwestern heat, man. It just sits on you. So there we go. Back into the Monster Mile. Taking a look at this one. So it's always interesting. It almost seems like when we build the story up of, hey, what could potentially happen, the opposite happens. That just goes to show. We just try to talk about stuff to build it up, right? Build a case. Our monster can is taking a dive back there. That just tells you how gnarly that Monster Mile is. And we wait for our riders to check in. Good look at the motocross track right there. And on the other side of this pond would be our finish line. So that's where they'll be coming in here. Leaders do in. We still got about 14 and a half minutes before the leaders check in. So this ought to be some of the B riders checking in here to the finish in a moment. And how about the start? We've got given you the top five again. We do have Cole Richardson out front, Devin Feehan in second, Bryson Neal in third, and Wesley Wolf in fourth, with Chris Borich rounding out the top five. How about the start to this race for the 741 Suzuki of Wesley Wolf? Great start to this race for him, and we actually had a chance to play a little game with him called, we got leaders coming through. We got leaders coming through the Monster Mile, so I did not get a good look at that. I'm busy looking at our next segment. Feehan back out in front, maybe? So maybe Feehan got around Cole Richardson. So that might have been the 406. Is this the number five? No, how about that? Chris Borich. So Chris Borich, unless we miss Cole Richardson coming through, I think Devin Feehan's out in front. Borich in the number two spot. And how about the McGill? I mean, he was last off the line, and he is just chipping away to get up there in the pack.
Wow, there goes Walker Fowler right there, finally making his way through. He's all the way back now in sixth place position. Wow. Still holding on to sixth place in these conditions. I mean, you know, we listened to Jared Bolton talk about slot car racing and slot carring, and that look, and that's exactly what he's talking about. There's, I mean, and that creates, and Landon Wolf, you're here in the booth. Go ahead and pipe in on this one right now, buddy, because, I mean, when you look at these conditions, being an ATV racer, you think, wow, there's plenty of lines out there. There's places to go. But once those kind of things develop, you can't hardly get out of those.
Those lines there, they filled up quick all day long. I like you say, I raced out there this morning, and it seemed like there were plenty of options, and I mean, this scenario we're seeing here on screen is the least of these guys' worries. I mean, there's some sections out there on the track that are much, much worse than this, and just make it for really, really gnarly conditions, but it's definitely created some mix-ups here in the front. I know, I think that right there is our XC2 leader, Ronnie Rush, coming through. I guess we still have Richardson. I think Richardson may still be out front. We just missed him on screen.
But that'd be my guess.
Yeah. It's different than normal, that's for sure.
So you're heading over to the pro pits to see what's going on over there, I guess?
Yeah, I think I'm going to head down there, watch them come through this lap, and maybe get some insight from the riders or the mechanics.
All righty, sounds good. That's Landon Wolf. He is a 4x4 pro ATV racer and as well one of our correspondents here on Racer TV as he's heading over to the pro pits right now. And with that, I'm sure he's going to get some really good scoops in on everything.
You want to sit here?
Yes, I do.
All
actually.
Right. I figured as much.
Stand by. See, Mikey realizes I can't see very well and offers me the chair closest to the TV and to the computer screen, which we certainly appreciate as we get situated here and get ready to go for today's race. We're back out in the mulch pile, this infamous mulch pile, one that started out years ago just as some plain old wood chips. That's all it was a pile of wood chips. The county came around. They had cleared all the roadways and different places around, and, you know, they mulched all this up, chipped up all this wood, and they put it out here. Actually, they were going to use it on the motocross track because that's when the moto track was still in operation and still doing a lot of events and so forth. So they stockpiled all that mulch over there to put into the dirt on the court, on the race course, but it turned into one of the funnest obstacles, I think, that we've got here at the Wiseco John Pinton GNCC, unless you like FMF hill climb action like this right here, Mikey Waynes. So we ran through several of our classes. We got one lap complete so far. We are 2 hours late on getting the racing action underway today. We had a scheduled 2 o'clock start. It was after 4 o'clock, I believe, before the green flag actually waved out here. So as Mikey Waynes said, racing into the evening. And look at that. Now, it's kind of deceiving again with the angle of the camera, that hill. But I think that gives to show you just how slick that things are out there, that you've got to negotiate that right with the right speed and the right momentum, or you're going to find yourself having to turn around, go back, and try it one more time. But as we take a look, it looks like we're about 7 minutes away, 6.5 minutes away from the finish line. Cole Richardson due in with lap number two complete. Devin Feehan in second, Bryson Neal in third, Wesley Wolf in fourth, and, of course, Chris Borch rounding out the top five. Walker Fowler back in the number six spot again. The historic markers for today, Walker Fowler is looking for win number 50. That will post him third. He's currently tied at 49 with Barry Hawk for third in the all-time wins category. Also, if Walker Fowler wins here, it will tie him with Chris Borch with six wins at the John Pitton, which is more than anyone has ever gotten here before. I think you've got the wrong.
Oh, there we go. That's much better.
So, yes, it's six wins, and that's what Walker's looking for, six straight here today. And at the same time, Chris Borch is also looking for win number seven. We can't take that away from him.
Yeah, this happened to us the round that Chris Borch won this season. That's what we kept talking about. We kept saying, oh, Walker Fowler's going to tie Barry Hawk. Walker Fowler's going to tie Barry Hawk, going for these wins. And then we forgot all day to mention the guy with the most wins, Chris Borch, and then Borch comes out and wins. I swear to you, I think Chris Borch heard us all morning long and said, not today, Mikey, not today, Rodney, I'm going to get it. Maybe that's what happens here today, or maybe Cole Richardson pulls a win out, or maybe Devin Feehan picks up his first XC win.
Right, and I know that is my mic working? Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Okay, yeah. I know that he is Cole Richardson is really looking for that big win, you know, the elusive win, especially here in 2019. He's gotten some really good runs. He finished right behind Walker. If anybody can say that they have consistently run with Walker early on, that would be Cole Richardson. Unfortunately, he's had a few downs during those times, so he's not been right where he needs to be whenever the checkers finally fly. But I say when Cole Richardson gets things put together, he's going to be possibly Walker Fowler's biggest nemesis.
I think you're right. And what a comeback story for him. He had the health issues, the physical issues. So here these last couple seasons, he's really been turning it on.
Most certainly. And today's racing, I think, is a true indication of what Cole is capable of. Again, recognizing that the conditions are what they are, but you've got to race these conditions whether you're doing, you know, whether you're champion and racing for championship points or not. And that's what these guys do. And Walker realizes that. Walker came out to win. It's not that Walker's laying back today. It's just that challenging of a race.
It is. This has been nuts. I saw crazy things this morning. I keep mentioning that. I saw some crazy things in the youth race. And then in the AM race, there was some chaos. And honestly, each race has not been without controversy, too. There's been some protests. And I'm just like, please, please let things go smoothly this afternoon. We'll see how it plays out. So far, it seems nothing in shock.
Nothing that we know of out of the ordinary. And that's good to know. So hopefully we'll continue at that pace. Again, we are less than, well, I'm calculating 4 minutes, less than 4 minutes away. I'm not sure how much time second laps add on to.
I'm not sure how much of the course they're not running on that first lap.
So we can expect maybe 3 to 5 minutes longer lap time, depending on where the start is in relation to the race course itself, on what part of the race course it is anyway. So we'll wait with bated breath, so to speak, and see what takes place. Lap times first time around, 25:10 for Cole Richardson. Devin Feehan, a 25:20, 25:24 for Bryson Neal. Wesley Wolf, who was running fourth, was 25:31, and Chris Borch ran a 25:42. Again, not sure what their lap times are, but when we're seeing these guys, we're not seeing real tight battling going on right now. It's just a war, I think, a ride to survive right now. And I think once we get into a situation where we're closer to the checker flag, we get to the end of the race and people start making mistakes, machines start to wear out things.
Yeah.
We're going to see crazy things happen, I think, before the checkers fly on this one. We are currently, according to timing and scoring, about 48 and a half minutes into this race. Well, 48:18 if you look at the TV time there. So that is still a little more than an hour, so a little more than half this race left to go. I'm going to assume that this is going to be a four-lap race. There's John Glotta checking in, the number 712. I believe Glotta is your second place, or was anyway, your second place.
That was, I believe, Drew Landers, the number 17 in front of him.
Okay, so we got a little bit of a change going on there. Let's see. Well, no, actually, I think Landers was in second, was he not, in that XC2? No, it was
third.
Rush. It was Glotta and Landers. So Landers has gotten around Glotta. That's big news right there, because those two have been consistently the ones we've watched battling up front this season so far. Drew always seems to get that early lead, gets out front, and then something happens, and he finds himself in second or third place position or even off the podium. But this might be the day that he gets it all put together.
That's exactly. And maybe two guys get it put together in front of him today. I believe Glott is undefeated on the season in class. So this would be the first time this season someone else has picked up a win, which a lot of racing left.
Yeah, and we can't count out Ronnie Rush. I'm talking about Drew Landers, but we got to talk about Ronnie Rush. He's been in a lot of those battles this season as well. And most importantly, he took that whole shot today like he wanted to take the win.
Yeah, it was impressive.
It was.
It was clean, perfect. It's good.
It was. It was textbook. That was amazing. He got a good jump off the line. He threaded that first turn just perfectly. Set himself up for the second turn, and wow, he hasn't looked back. He's gained 41.8 seconds over the fastest guy so far this season consistently, John Glotta, who's back in that second place position. So that's telling you something about Ronnie Rush and what he wants to do today.
Yeah, it's impressive to watch him rise. I remember, I believe it was the year before, seeing him race the AM race, and he would consistently get on the podium and sometimes take the overalls on adjusted time. So
yeah.
It's like you always say, it's really neat to watch these guys come up through the ranks, GNCC.
Well, coming up through the ranks, coming around for the second lap complete, we should be seeing our XC1 riders checking in. We're looking for Cole Richardson.
Oh, that looked like Bryson Neal, unless I missed somebody.
Nope, you're right. They're absolutely right. That is Bryson Neal just ahead now of Cole Richardson, the Ohio boy in his backyard, literally Bidwell, Ohio, the Bullet. Has taken aim, my friends. Can he keep it rolling with the Cole train right behind him? Look at this.
That's good racing.
Only a couple of bike lengths separating these riders as they roll across this Sunday Creek Raceway motocross track. Been home to some of the greatest amateur national qualifiers that you've ever seen.
That's Ronnie. That is what the wheel-to-wheel right there.
Yes, it is. As we go back to our now third place position, Devin Feehan checks in. What a ride for that young man so far today. Looking next for Wesley Wolf to check in. There's 36 seconds. Now look at this. We had Bryson Neal and Cole Richardson 1.6 seconds apart, 36.8 seconds back to the third place position now. And we're still waiting on fourth place position to check in. That's not good news for Walker Fowler and his bid for the win number 50 today, because the longer it takes fourth place to check in, we know the longer it's going to take. And where is Walker Fowler? Adam McGill checks in fourth place aboard the 521. Chris Borch checks in fifth place now. So McGill is working his way up through the pack. Chris Borch stays steady. Wesley Wolf drops off a couple of spots now into sixth place. Wait a minute. Walker Fowler has checked in. There's the seven. Okay, so here it is. Walker Fowler is in now in sixth place. Wesley Wolf in seventh. Hunter Hart and eighth.
Neal's getting a pit stop, and it looked like I saw the Feehan crew
wave him on through?
No. I think they were going to stop him for fuel as well.
Okay, so.
And I saw Cole Richardson go out. I'm not sure. I don't know if Landon's down there, if he saw whether or not. I got to think Cole Richardson got fuel as well. Otherwise, he'd have passed Bryson in that pit.
Yeah, with 1.6 seconds separating those guys, that for sure is the case, I would believe. Feehan, Adam McGill, Chris Borch all checking in. Walker Fowler, as we said, in sixth place. He's 5 seconds behind Chris Borch now.
Feehan getting some fuel, some water, new set of goggles. They had the goggles in hand, no new set of goggles.
Interesting choice, I believe, there. You go that extra mile, you think you would go ahead and make that switch, but
unless their hands were muddy. I just saw mud on the side of the goggles. I may have missed it.
Yeah.
Everything's covered in mud.
He may pick up goggles someplace else on the course. They only have the fuel in the pits. They can get other things taken care of, like goggles and stuff like that out on the trail someplace. But regardless, more riders checking in down there in the pits. Looks like we got Hunter Hart in for this one now. There's Mama Amy.
Santo Derisi down there helping out.
Yeah, Santo, a former XC1.
He said, I got choices for you, man. Water. Woo, that was tight.
Yes, it was. So Hunter Hart is in and out. Hart checked in eighth place that lap around Mikey. I think that puts him up a position. Jared McClure checked in ninth place position. Marty Christopherson in 10th. This is for the overall. Ronnie Rush has dropped to 11th place overall, but still leads the XC2 class. And as we look a little further into that, we're still waiting on XC2 Pro-Am riders to check in. But here's another interesting point to ponder. Johnny Gallagher, who's 41 years old, in 15th place position. In 16th place position, your senior A 40-plus class leader on time adjustment. In 17th place position, second in the senior A 40-plus division. I just wanted to point that out. Those guys, 15, 16, and 70, all plus 40. But that's where Johnny is. And another thing I wanted to point out, senior A is our top amateur class right now.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah, I didn't think about that.
So far, they're the only ones checking in with top 20 overall scores other than XC1 and XC2 riders. We see Ronnie Rush has checked in. On time adjustment now, drops to 12th place overall. Josh Merritt is behind him in time adjustment, 13th. Then Greg Cover checking in, 14th overall. Britt Sturdivant, good to see that name back with us again, the 149 and 15th. We'll see him in West Virginia at Snowshoe also, I'm pretty sure. Looking at Johnny Gallagher now in 16th, Tom Barrett in 17th, Brian Shaw in 18th. And another update here real quick. Actually, that is John Glotta checking in finally. Second place of the XC2 Pro-Am. He is 17th in the XC2. 1:09 out of the lead. Drew Landers is only 2 seconds behind him. So Glotta's gotten around Landers. Last time we saw this a few moments ago, it was Landers in front of Glotta. So Glotta's back out in front of him. 1:09 though between them and Ronnie Rush. It's going to be interesting to see whether they can bridge that gap or not. Lap time, 27:22 for Glotta last time. Ronnie Rush, a 26:55. Sounds like Rush has got this one, at least for the moment. We'll see what happens after lap three. We're 55, almost 56 minutes into this race, and just a little over an hour of racing left to go. And we've got John Sousa checking in with a 23-minute lap time. I'd say that might be a little bit of an issue, but currently a third place overall. So we'll see if they check that and see what happens. That's a heartbreaker because we saw those bottlenecks out there. And sometimes these guys say they do what they think is right, but unfortunately sometimes they might get on like a road that takes them 5 miles ahead of the course. We saw that happening a lot. You know, kids running 25-minute lap times were running 11-minute lap times next lap. It didn't make sense. Yeah. So they're getting sorted out. I mean, conditions like this, bottlenecks, I mean, riders just start searching for those lines, and they pop out wherever they can. And sometimes they gain a bigger advantage than what they realize.
It's almost a two-edged sword. From what everybody says, there's so many line choices out there, which on one side makes for great racing. The other side of that sword is it can cause a little chaos, and you get, you know, lost in the thick of things.
Exactly. And let's hope that we get it all sorted out. I think we will with not much problem. So Neil Richardson, Feehan in the Pro Class 1, 2, and 3. Adam Gill in 4. Chris Bort still rounding out the top 5. And again, Walker Fowler's win number 50 in jeopardy here at the halfway point of today's race. I know Landon Wolf is down in the pit area right now, and I'm sure a lot of folks are wondering what is going on with Walker Fowler. Mark Notman, I'm sure, and the entire Walker Fowler Racing crew, probably not in the pits for very long, but hopefully Landon's able to get a little intel as to what's going on and what the plan of attack for the rest of the day may be.
Little of that hometown or home state pressure on Walker. But, boy, I feel like this is a home state for everybody.
You're right.
The GNCC Nation runs deep in Ohio.
Well, Bryson Neal, as we told you, I mean, he lives in Bidwell, Ohio, which is like a county and a half over or something like that. We're in Athens County. He's in Gallia County, about 45 minutes, maybe an hour for him to drive to get here. You're utilizing that pond for the best thing possible today.
Exactly.
But
I'm a little jealous.
TV. But Bryson Neal, you know, I was talking to him this morning. He said, you know, this is one that he really wants to get. He needs to get that confidence back. Wow. And
Adam Gordon just...
All right, you just totally took me off.
Yeah, it throws us off. I don't know if you've seen this yet, which the folks at home are about to see it. But to preface it, Johnny Gallagher was tagged in a post earlier, as you guys see on screen, with the nice frosted tips there. We had a chance to catch up with him. Or did you got the interview, Adam? All right, yeah, let's kick that interview. Let's do the interview with him.
Listen, man,
That was, I believe that was like 2001 or 2000, right around there, back in the old Huevos videos, Huevos Grandes, and somebody screenshotted one of the videos they saw on the TV somewhere when they were, and yeah, I had frosted tips, and all I can say is, hey man, it was the 90s. Everybody had frosted tips. Early 2000s, the 90s, you know, if you wanted to be cool, you had to get out the sun in. I didn't go get highlights. It was just sun in. I sprayed it in, combed it through, you know, a little bit of highlights. I'm not ashamed of it, man. I looked good.
Yeah, you did, Johnny. I had highlights too, man.
I did too. That's exactly what I told him. I was like, okay, tooth that. Yep, nope, I definitely had highlights. You know, not proud of it.
We all laugh at it, but we all had them, I think. Mine were natural, though.
Got to have that. Yeah, to have that Johnny or that Jeremy McGrath look, right?
Bryson Neal, Cole Richardson, and Devin Feehan lead them 1, 2, and 3. Adam McGill in fourth, and Chris Borich in fifth. And it looks like Walker Fowler's win number 50 may be in jeopardy in Ohio, or is it? A 5-lap race is on the way. Stick around. GNCC Live continues after this.
You're giving the fries away here? This guy wants to try some fries. French fries.
Wow. I don't know. It's a nightmare.
You got all these guys that are like, oh, I'm on this meal plan and I'm training and programming. Like, I literally drink a Dr. Pepper with my dinner and I'm eating fries and grease. I mean, I don't really care. I like French fries. I'm Wesley Wolf, and you're watching Racer TV.
The halfway point is here, and these riders have endured over an hour now of hard battling through the woods at extremely high heart rates, the type the average athlete couldn't even fathom for this level of distance. Can they stick with it to the end? Don't click that X. GNCC Live on RacerTV.com continues after this. It's tough out here in the great outdoors. It's summertime, and things will get heated. Do you have what it takes to be part of the action? The Lucas Oil Pro Motocross Championship will put you to the test, but reward you with the thrill of a lifetime. Join the fastest motocross racers in the world as they endure the elements and the toughest racetracks in America for national championship glory. Tickets for the High Point National in Mount Morris, Pennsylvania on June 15th. Available at promotocross.com.
Your bearings shoulder the burden whenever you tow, haul, or stop the gas. AMSOIL delivers powerful protection for bearings and other critical components so you can drive with confidence. To demonstrate, an independent lab put AMSOIL synthetic motor oil head-to-head against a leading competitor in a 100,000-mile test. AMSOIL provided far superior wear protection and kept engine bearings looking like new. Get your truck the protection it deserves at AMSOIL.com/auto.
I'm a junior pro surfer from Maui, Hawaii. I actually tried to homeschool in 8th grade and just didn't meet my needs. I came to On Track in 9th grade, and from the beginning I really liked it.
The mission at On Track School is to make academic success completely possible for each and every student while they're out pursuing their personal goals.
Everything is just super easy with On Track. I get to take my computer on the road whenever I need to. It makes it very easy for me to get all my work done.
If you're looking for a program that provides flexibility and a program that you can take anywhere that fits your lifestyle, then On Track is for you. So come check us out at ontrackschool.com and go get it.
Even when you're the best, you never stop striving to be better. The all-new from the ground up 2019 Yamaha YZ250F is available at LoJack Cycle Sales, alongside the all-new YZ65 and YZ85 and refined YZ450F. So stop by LoJack Cycle Sales today in Tarentum, Pennsylvania, and visit our online inventory at www.lojax.com. Yamaha YZs. It's why we ride. We are American motorcyclists. We are members of the American Motorcyclist Association. Racers, fans, and crew. We come together for this sport we love, to race together, to grow together. We start young and not so young. We race motorcycles and ATVs. We become friends. We become family. We compete for weekend bragging rights and national championships. We make memories on the toughest off-road courses in the country and on the best motocross tracks in the world. Some of us aspire to the speed and poise of road racing or the fierce competitiveness of American flat track. And we honor our greatest champions in the AMA Motorcycle Hall of Fame. Through it all, we cheer, we win, and we lose. We are racing. We are the AMA. Race with us. Be part of the greatest sport in the world. Be an American motorcyclist. Join us today at www.amajoin.com www.ccrsportsmedia.com/join-now.
CC Live. I'm Rodney Tomlin along with Mikey Waynes, and of course Landon Wolf is joining us as well out and about. And of course we are at the Weisco John Pinton GNCC as we celebrate our 30th running here in the hills of southeastern Ohio, currently being led by Ohio native and Bidwell Bullitt just around the corner, so to speak, from right here at Millfield, Bryson Neal. Cole Richardson out of Edinburgh, Pennsylvania, running in second. Then we've got Devin Feehan, sophomore out of Windsor, New York, running in the number three spot after a two-race break. And he had a broken scapula. He's got that all healed back up now. And he is back with us in third right now. Adam McGill in fourth, and fifth is Chris Forge. Walker Fowler, who's looking for win number 50, back at the number six spot. Seventh place is Wesley Wolf. Eighth place, Hunter Hart. Ninth place, Jared McClure. And Marty Christofferson rounds out your top 10. That's all of our XC1 Pro guys in that top 10. Now, Ronnie Rush is running back there, leading the XC2 Pro Am class. He had about a minute and 9 second lead over John Glotta and Drew Landers, who are running second, third, nose to tail when we last checked in on those two riders. So that's the way things are looking right now. We're watching here on lap two at the Monster Mile. And if I'm not mistaken, I believe our producer told us we were going to be looking at, I believe, a five lap race, and doing some math. We got 15 minutes before, so we'll be seeing our leaders come in at this particular shot at the Monster Mile here in just a few moments. So if we're running 25-minute lap times, yeah, that's going to be one of those little over two-hour possibly races, or right at that two-hour mark. And these conditions in the heat and and the humidity, I think, is level starting to raise as much as anything. That's what the real challenge is. This racetrack, Mikey Waynes, is the true challenge. I know Landon Wolf can tell us about it. He was out there earlier today. And I think these high-definition cameras that we have at various locations throughout this property of the Russell Family Farm tells a pretty good story also.
I think this is, as you know this a heck of a lot better than I do, but when I think of a GNCC, this John Penton right we have here today is exactly what I think of when I think of GNCC. It's got absolutely everything.
Now, this hill right here, I love this hill. I've done reclaim back here at this racetrack, and that's a fun hill when it's dry. And it's a tough hill to reclaim when it's dry. I have no idea how these guys have been able to traverse this hillside at this particular point. And believe it or not, you know, it seems like this is around the 7 mile marker almost every year.
Yeah.
7.5 mile marker is what we're looking at the FMF PowerPoint. Hey, we got Landon Wolf in the pits with Mark Notman. We want to know what's going on with Walker Fowler, where we might find out. What's going on, Landon?
Hey, guys, down here with Mark Notman, Walker Fowler's mechanic. I know he had a little bit of a slow start to the day, struggling a little bit to get through the pack, it looks like. And I saw you guys had some fuel ready for him, and it doesn't look like he took it. What's the word on that?
No, he didn't take it. It's worked out in the past for us doing that. Obviously, we didn't want to do it, didn't think we should do it, but he knows what the track's like, how much fuel he's using, so we left it up to him. I think he went from seventh to fourth by not stopping. So hopefully we can get a little gap there this lap and pit him for fuel the next.
Sounds like we might be running a five-lap race, so who knows? Might work out to be the perfect plan after all, so we'll keep an eye on him.
Interesting. That is very interesting. Mark Hoffman, yeah. Your crew chief is wanting to stop you. You elect to go on. Now, I know they do a lot of testing and fuel mileage and stuff like that. They know the conditions. Walker knows probably as well as Mark does. And I have to think, though, I think Mark Notman might be a little bit worried right now.
He could kind of tell, a little bit.
Yeah, he didn't come out and say it, but I could hear it in his voice. He trusts Walker's judgment, but at the same time, he realizes the conditions, and he just don't want to take that chance. And I think that's as much as anything. He just didn't want to take that chance. But like he said, from seventh to fourth place, that's a pretty good move if he can capitalize throughout the rest of this lap now.
You also got to think, too, if they happen to get caught in some kind of gnarly bottleneck, and Walker's got to sit there eating fuel. So, I mean, if everything runs smooth, we'll even forget we even talked about this. So,
right.
But there's always that what if. We've got to create drama, doggone it. So.
And that is the hype right now. Can Walker Fowler make another lap on the fuel that he has? Everyone else has pitted. The conditions obviously may or may not warrant that pit stop. Walker feels that it didn't. Feels like he had plenty of fuel, so it's going to be interesting to wait and find out. Well, I tell you, we got some pretty cool things going on with our riders, I believe, here in GNCC. And, you know, we oftentimes ask questions this or that. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
That's been some of the best ones, I think, that we've done so far this season. And this year, you had a chance, or this week, you had a chance, Mikey, to sit down with Wesley Wolf and talk with him about this or that. And I believe we may take an opportunity to take a look at that right now, if I'm not mistaken. Well, I guess Adam must have changed gears on me. So, nonetheless, we'll get to that coming up here in a few moments. But, yeah. All right. Let's go ahead. Let's do this or that now with Wesley Wolf and Mikey Waynes.
Hey, guys. I'm here with Wesley Wolf, and we're going to do a real quick hit called This or That. Wesley Wolf, Coke or Pepsi?
Pepsi.
Pepsi. All right. Star Wars or Star Trek?
Never watched any of them.
Great. All right. This is going fantastic. All right. What's your favorite 80s movie? Were you even alive in the 80s?
No.
No. God bless. All right. Let's do Bon Jovi or Guns N' Roses?
Limp Bizkit.
Okay. That's wrong. Let's do Thumb Throttle or Twist Throttle?
Twist Throttle.
Why?
Because I like it.
Because I like it. All right. Technical track or fast track?
Fast.
Why?
Why not?
Just love to go fast.
That was a good one.
We had questions laid out for him, and I'm thinking, I don't think he's probably seen these movies because I don't think he's old enough. That's sure enough. Oh, there we go. There's Bryson Neal moving through right there. So I didn't catch. Did you catch if anybody was out in front of him, Rodney? We may still have Bryson out in
still
front.
I think that Bryson's still out front. We'll see here in just a moment. Cole was only 1.1 seconds behind him.
Maybe there was some Cole in there.
Yeah, Cole. Maybe we missed Cole. We'll see right here. Who do we got coming through now? Looks like some amateur riders coming through. So we may have had Cole out front. That was a pro rider. I'm not sure.
I think that might have been Walker. That's Walker with the chest protector.
Up to third place now, it looks like. Walker may have gotten third unless I missed third place, and he's still in fourth place position.
Well, like Mark Notman said, that gamble he took on the fuel pushed him from seventh up into the fourth place spot. So completely reasonable thinking if he pushed up into the number three position. And boy, if it gets bottled up there is not really any place for those guys to go.
Wow, I'm sitting here and I'm looking at this. Walker made up some major time there. 7, 28, 30. I mean, we're talking
there goes
well
McGill
over,
and Borich.
Wow, close to a minute of time somehow or another he's made up out there, believe it or not. Wow, that's if he was as close to Bryson as what it seemed like when they came through there a minute ago. Walker is on rails right now.
Yeah.
And obviously, it's hard not to be whenever you look at this
racetrack
right here. You're railing around there no matter what you want to do in a lot of these places. But, yeah, I can't wait to see. I believe our next shot might be coming up probably close to the finish line. We might catch him on the moto track or something like that here in a few moments. So we'll get a better bird's eye view of whether Richardson's gotten around Bryson Neal, whether Devin Feehan and Adam McGill were able to fend off Walker Fowler. But it looks like Fowler's gotten around at least McGill, and possibly that might have been Feehan that I missed going through there. And then Walker Fowler coming in behind him. So that still could put Walker Fowler in that number four spot. But he's not far out of the reach of a podium position finish right now. And in reality, in my sense of timing, didn't seem real far behind Bryson Neal in the number one spot.
Yeah, you're exactly right. But what a confidence booster it is for Devin Feehan. I mean, you talk about, he talked about it a little bit yesterday when we talked to him, just the difference of last year really kind of learning and then being able to key off of these guys, trying to get up there and run with the front runners. Today, if nothing else, he's working on a podium finish, but if nothing else, this is just a huge confidence booster and definitely a major learning experience for him. As some of our amateur riders working their way through the Monster Mile.
Sorry, man, I'm looking through some stuff here and looking ahead right now. But yeah, an hour and 13 minutes into this race now. We've got two laps down. We're still working on lap number three. So yeah, we might, these laps are probably getting a little bit longer.
Yep.
And
bikes are getting heavier.
Bikes are getting heavier. Riders are getting more tired. for the most part. But Walker Fowler appears to be picking up speed. This is nothing untraditional for Walker, except that we normally see him do it like lightning earlier in the race. He bided his time. And you know what? That right there goes to show you a seasoned veteran rider, a true champion.
Yeah.
And instead of going for the gusto in the early part of this race, he knew that the opportunity would have presented itself. And he took that whenever he saw everyone in the pits. He says, I can make up about four positions right here, about three positions. And he did just exactly that. And you see where it's got him in position on the racetrack. And you know when all of a sudden the guys up front hear that Walker's gone from sixth place now up to fourth and knocking on the door of third, it's going to start rattling some cages up there. Even
yep.
Bryson Neal, who seems to be confident and comfortable up front, about 40 seconds ahead of what I would expect to be Walker Fowler's position right now on the racetrack. But as this race or as this lap wears on, I think that Walker just continually gets closer and closer and closer.
Yeah, it's definitely it's going to work on your brain there. Johnny Gallagher making his way through the Monster Mile there, and I believe that was Josh Merritt who was up in front of him. But yeah, that's got to play on your mind. Like if you're feeling good, you know Walker's back in six, and now all of a sudden he's knocking on the door for third place. It's just like, man, you got to be kidding me. What do we got to do? Because at this point, I mean, they're out there in the woods, they're racing. They have no idea that he didn't stop for fuel.
Exactly. So. We should be seeing Ronnie Rush come through here in the next few moments on the 714 machine. As that was at last, we know, leader of the XC2 Pro-Am class. A minute and 9 second lead he had over John Glotta and Drew Landers. And there is little Ronnie Rush. I think we ought to start calling him Rockin' Ronnie Rush.
Yeah, right?
He's rocking
it. Keeps riding like this.
Yeah, if he keeps riding like this, we will. And you pointed out, you know, it took him a while to get into that that mode of winning those overalls in the morning. Once he did, though, man, he didn't look back. And that could be the same instance and case that we're looking at for XC2 Pro-Am class racing for this young rider also.
It's been interesting. I've been wondering all year. Well, I wondered coming into this year. I felt like John Glotta was going to be the favorite in that XC2 class. And I kept wondering who, as the season progressed, who's going to be the guy to knock John Glotta off the center of that box. And they're doing work on him today, making it hard on him.
I'll tell you right now, Ronnie Rush has got him in position. Drew Landers has had him in this position a couple of times so far this year, too. But somehow or another, Glotta has been able to thread needles and pull him out, pull rabbits out of his hat out there. And we're ramping up lap number three now with our XC1 Pro class. And looks like we should be seeing how this is shaping up. Bryson Neal was leading at last check, and as expected, that was Cole Richardson.
Cole Richardson
had gotten around. So Bryson Neal now 4 seconds behind. So Cole was just ahead of Bryson Neal, and that's just exactly where they are right now. A 25:37 lap time for Cole Richardson, a 25:43 for Bryson Neal, and only 4.3 seconds separating the two. Now let's see where that big gap is. Now Devin Feehan or Walker Fowler should be checking in next, quite possibly. As we watch, is that Bryson Neal rolling?
Bryson Neal on screen with Cole in front of him. Cole trying to pull away.
We'll see if it happens. I know that both these guys do a lot of training on the moto track, so don't know if either one of these guys will have an advantage or not. Here comes our third place ride, and that is, you guessed it, the number one, Walker Fowler, 46 seconds behind Bryson Neal. That puts him 50 seconds out of first place, and Cole Richardson with two laps to go. An hour and 16 minutes into this race, here's what's going to happen. A 25-minute lap time would put us at an hour and 43 minutes, which is not enough. So we've got to go that extra lap, that fifth lap, which will take us over the two-hour mark by about 5 to 10 minutes or so. But regardless, that's what we got to do to get the right amount of time in on this race, and that might play favor to Walker Fowler. The longer this race goes on,
yep,
the more favor it plays for him, and he realizes that this is a long race. The only thing that he has to worry about right now is making his way back around to the pro pits and getting that fuel. If he runs out of fuel, that'll be the biggest heartbreaker of all. And I know that he's not worried about it, but I know that he's got a few people walking on the coals over there right now, wondering what in the world's going to happen.
chomping at the bit.
Yeah.
What's the scenario? What's the ruling on that? If a pro rider runs out of fuel mid-track, is it his track crew that's got to bring him the fuel?
No.
Is that it?
No.
You're done.
He can obtain fuel. It doesn't matter where he obtains fuel outside his designated pro pit area. Sufficient only enough to allow him to continue along the course to his pits where he must refuel. Particular point. So
there you go. Well, that answers our question right there. He made it.
So Mark Knottman, you can breathe a sigh of relief.
Yeah, you know he is.
Now, so that's still, we're about 50 seconds out from the front of the class. Here we go, 27 seconds behind Walker Fowler's Chris Borch. Adam McGill checks in another 8 seconds back. So we got Richardson, Neal, Fowler, Borch, and McGill, your top five. And I got to tell you, the Fowler, Borch, McGill thing is no surprise whatsoever. I expected to see those three in a top five battle. Cole Richardson, you can always expect to see him in any condition to be battling it out up there. So, in reality, I think everybody that we kind of anticipated being at the front of this pack is there. One rider that I am kind of missing out on is Jared McClure, Sneaky Snake.
Yeah.
The rider, after a phenomenal season last year and pulling off the number two, has had nothing but struggles so far here in 2019. And what a heartbreaker for the Sneaky Snake, for sure.
Yeah, he certainly I mean, not to dog him, not dogging him at all, but I felt like he would do a lot better this year coming into it.
Why are you being so hard on him?
I know, right? It's terrible. I'll hear about it later, I know.
No, you're right. He expected more. He wanted more, and he hoped for more, and rightfully so. And but, hey, you know, this is the way the cookie crumbles. Sometimes you got to take it as it rolls. Hey, speaking of rolling, Hunter Hart rolling up to a sixth-place position. Now, this starting to see Hunter stretch his legs here about the midway point. I think this is going to be a good and a big race for Hunter Hart on a lot of different levels. Normally we see him get hooked up with another rider out there, and he kind of keys off that other rider in this XC1 Pro class. Today it looks like I think that Hunter's kind of setting his own pace and kind of setting the idea. It's a minute and 36 seconds to the next position ahead of him, and he's got a 12-second bumper ahead of him now over Wesley Wolf. So Hunter's got this going on. This is a little different scenario than we generally see Hunter in, so we'll see what he can do with it. Right now, it's looking like he's doing a pretty good job.
He is. Hunter Hart's one of those guys. I can tell a huge difference in him from last season in his maturity level. It seems like when he was winning those XC2 races, the way he raced was just go out there, go as hard and fast as possible. That was even in his personality and his interviews. And now it seems like he's just taking leaps and bounds in his maturity level and is doing some pretty great things out there. How about that? Layden Wolf out there helping out, pulling double duty.
Was that Wesley Wolf they were helping out?
Well, Landon was helping him pit.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I believe that was Wesley Wolf right there.
Yeah, so that was cool to see that. And those guys have been buddies since way back when. Good to see that he's got the opportunity. Now, there's Devin Feehan now in the pits. Now, this is a second stop. Didn't he pit last time?
Well, okay, so that answers it, because I was almost positive his last time around he did not get goggles.
Yep.
So there you go. He got the goggle change right there.
Very,
he's in good shape.
Very impressive, to say the least, Mikey. Keeping a close eye out on that, watching the way things are unfolding here at this 30th running of the Wise Code. John Pent, GNCC, still big things on the horizon, I feel, as history is likely going to be set here in some way, shape, or form today. An hour and 20,
I don't know.
2 minutes nearly.
I'm no ATV racer, but I think that outside line is the one. That inside line just looks too rough, too slow.
It's so much shorter, though, Mikey.
It is shorter. But that's why I'm sitting here in the booth and they're out there racing.
There you go. Hey, listen, no shorters and no shortcuts coming up in the future. GNCC University returns. It's the Snowshoe campus June 19th through the 21st as Yamaha's top off-road ATV and motorcycle racers, along with select other top riders in the industry, will be on hand as instructors for the riding school beginning just before the AMSOIL Snowshoe GNCC, which is round 8 of this 2019 GNCC season. We got seven-time AMA National Enduro Champion Randy Hawkins going to be doing that. And, of course, this year's bike instructors include five-time AMA national champion, hair scramble racer Jason Raines, XC1 rider Ricky Russell, and WXC competitors Rachel Archer and Becca Sheets. On the ATV side of things, Johnny Gallagher will lead this year's Yamaha Racing Academy, and he'll be included with him. Four-time AMA national GNCC champion Walker Fowler and 11-time women's class champion Tracy Pickens. Reservations on a first-come, first-served basis and only 40 spots each for both bike and ATV disciplines, totaling 80 spots. Students must provide their own equipment and be at least 8 years of age, and machines must be at least an 85cc or larger. That's June 19th through the 21st. You can contact Snowshoe Mountain Resort. You can call them up to get registered for that. 877-441-4366. That's 877-441-4386. That's 86, not 66, 86. And you can also find all this information on gnccracing.com, which will help you afford you the information to get to what you need to know. Also want to salute our hometown heroes this week from 100%. And, of course, Raylan Dickerson and Xander Rogers from the 50 Senior 6-7 class. Hannah Moore from the Girls 8-15 class, and Ashton Poling from the Schoolboy Junior 13-15-year-old class. These riders went out, they hung up posters in the local area. They also did a lot of social media work and tried to promote things on a local local way, and we certainly appreciate it for that. They get themselves a new pair of 100% goggles, as well as free race entry fee here to the White's coach, John Pinton, GNCC. Thanks to 100% and our 100% hometown heroes.
It's an amazing program. I love that. Pretty well, awesome.
It is. It most certainly is. And another program that I like, a Moto Hero program.
Yeah.
I think that is
pretty
amazing.
Special.
AMSOIL stepping up with that. They're getting like $250 worth of AMSOIL products, however they want to spend it. A brand new set of tires from GBC. They for their truck, light truck tires, their mother company providing those. So
I didn't know that part.
Yeah,
that's pretty solid.
Yeah, that's about $1,000 worth
of
tires that those guys get, as well as the actual stuff. So, and while we're talking about Moto Hero, you can go on to gnccracing.com to find out more about this. But we ask for nominations at each and every round for heroes, whether it be local responders or Army, Armed Forces. Armed Forces, but all you got to do is check out GNCCRacing.com, nominate your person, and they may be picked. Sounds like Landon Wolf is standing by down in the VP Fuels Pro Row. What's going on, LW?
I'm down here with Kara Merritt, Josh Merritt's sister, big help to his program. One thing we've noticed Josh has been doing last race for the first time ever, I think, and now I saw he did it again this race. He's switching helmets when he does his first pit.
Yeah.
What's the story behind that?
You know, last race, we didn't even know he was going to do it. He kind of came down pro row and just pointed at his head. No idea what he was talking about. So he came close, and I figured it out and ran into the trailer and got it. And he told me he was thinking about doing it this race because we noticed a lot of the AM guys were kind of grabbing the mud off their helmets. And it makes a big difference on your neck and just holding your head up and then your helmet sliding down in front of your face. So I think it's about the same time to change goggles, to put a helmet on too, so why not while we're in here? And if it makes him happy and it's more comfortable for him, then let's do it.
It's almost like a cold glass of water, but it's a fresh, lightweight helmet. So looks like it's working for him. I think he's going to continue to do it in these mud races. And, you know, never know. You might see the rest of the XC1 guys doing it as well.
Hey, you know, that's just it, Landon. I can't understand why folks haven't done this before. Why
yeah,
someone
it makes
hasn't
sense.
I mean, because really, that's one thing that people talk about. Their helmets get heavy, you know, put that foam on top of their helmet. And after that first lap, like today, a lot of that stuff was blown off. So the rest of the laps, that should remain light the rest of the day. So very good thinking by Josh Merritt. Hey, innovative stuff. And that's why we start to see his results start to get better as well. We're seeing him solidly up into the top 10s on a more consistent basis now. And of course, with that, Mikey, I know that we've been hard at work. We got, you know, we keep talking about all these pro riders, but hey, we got some amateur riders out there too.
Yeah, and we actually, the amateur of the week this week was Drew Blackley, Cometic sales rep and rider here at the GNCC. And I believe we had a chance to catch up with him. I'm not positive on that, but I think we did.
We did.
So for Kometic, I'm the product line manager. I take control of the power sports line. So any new product that comes in, I try to provide the best possible product for the consumer. Full-time student, I go to Cleveland State for organizational leadership. That's typically going to be online just because of all the traveling that I'm doing. So every other weekend we're racing, and then I get home on a Sunday and I'll end up doing my classwork. And online typically works the best for me at this moment. So yeah, we work 40 hours in the office during the week, and then on the weekends we'll come to the races, whether that's a GNCC, an amateur motocross. We specialize in a lot of different racing series, and that's what we do on the weekends. The hardest part about managing racing in school is the time management aspect of things. So pretty much you get home from a race on a Sunday, you got to clean, prep everything, and then you got to juggle schoolwork as well, and hopefully throw a social life in there as well. I think I'd probably be going, it is stressful, I'd probably be going crazy if I wasn't doing it, so I prefer to handle this workload as it is. One word to describe GNCC, I'd probably say gnarly. It's just a tough sport, it's a fun sport, and you got to put your big boots on in order to do it. Yeah, as I said, I work for Kometic Gasket, and I just want to give a big thank you to Kometic and all the people that send me out to these races. It's a family-owned operation over there in Concord, Ohio.
Drew Blackley, congratulations to you, our feature amateur rider of the week. And wow, I mean, going to school, working full-time.
It's a lot.
Doing rider resumes and keeping taking care of all the riders and going to school on top. Wow, that guy. I mean,
it's too much.
I mentioned going to school twice and racing. I mean, on top. I mean, that's all. That wow. No wonder he is our feature amateur rider of the week this week. So thanks, Drew. We appreciate all the effort and hard work that you put into living this lifestyle. Right now, Cole Richardson, Bryson Neal, Walker Fowler, Chris Borch, and Adam McGill, your top five. 4 seconds separating first and second. Walker Fowler was about 46 seconds back. He did stop in the pits to fuel. Remember, he didn't stop when everyone else stopped. He went from seventh to fourth place position. He's now up to third. Paid huge dividends for him. He's still about a minute out of first place behind Cole Richardson at last check. It'll be interesting to see whether or not he's able to bridge that gap. And when we take a look at lap times right now, 25:37 is what we saw Cole Richardson, and that's blistering. Bryson Neal at 25:43, but get this, a 25:22 for Walker Fowler. That is 15 seconds faster. So, wow, it's going to take a few of those 15-second laps. He's going to have to pick it up a little bit more than that, and or Cole Richardson and Bryson Neal are going to have to drop it a little bit in order for him to be able to bridge that gap. But I'm going to tell you right now, if anybody's capable of bridging it, it's Walker Fowler. We've seen him do it time and time again. We saw him go from ninth to first place on the first lap down in Florida.
Here we go. There's another line choice there, though.
There is another line choice, and this
and
is
I did just see Bryson Neal. Well, there's one line choice left. I saw Bryson Neal run up through there, so I'm not sure if Cole Richardson was up there with him or not.
Maybe
Walker was up there with him too now. Maybe you've got two guys out in front of Bryson.
Well, Walker, again, should it be at least, I would gather, at least maybe 30 seconds, 30 to 40 seconds still back behind. That's Walker.
That's Walker right there, and he looks at both of those lines and says, okay, I got one choice.
No, can't do but that right there. Walker gets through without any issue now. As you saw those guys come through, we're still about the 40-second range we're looking at right now.
I would say that's exactly right.
There is Chris Borch making his way through now on the number three machine. He is running, wow, it said 27 seconds at the finish line, but again, the pit stop tightened that up. I think we're down closer to like a 15-second gap between Walker Fowler and Chris Borch. Wouldn't it be interesting to see Chris Borch get that fire that you talked about earlier just to try to stop Walker? He wouldn't even have to win the race today, but just stop Walker from
that's
advancing.
Exactly right. There's something there for sure.
Yeah, and as much as these guys respect each other and as much as they admire each other, there is that competitive edge that they each and every one share. Competitiveness breeds hate sometimes.
Yep.
And though they may not hate them per se personally, but they hate them as a competitor.
Right.
I think these guys may not necessarily, I wouldn't use hate as a stronger word for these guys, but some strong dislike as far as competition, competing against each other.
A different person comes alive when the green flag flies.
It does. And
there's a saying about that, but I can't say it. We all know how that goes. When the green flag drops, the stuff stops.
That's it. That's it. We get into it. But nonetheless, I mean, just an amazing group of riders. But, you know, there still are those little backstory wars that go on. Chris, of course, you got to look at the fact that Chris Bortz was on top of his game when Walker Fowler came in. He's the one that knocked him off of.
Yeah.
And those guys have had some torrid battles. I mean, going all the way back to 2014 in that final race at Ironman GNCC to this day, and before that, I mean, we have seen some crazy things. And I'm wanting to think that that could possibly rear its head again here today. We might could see that happen, depending, again, on what happens. Walker Fowler seems to be burning it up out there. We do see that Chris Bortz turned to 25.55. Walker Fowler did get by him on that lap. But, again, there is inspiration there. He's about to beat his record, and he's about to take win number 50. And I know that Chris, as well as you know, don't want to see that happen, at least not yet. He wants to make it hold off for as long as he can.
Yep. So we did see Bryson Neal go up the FMF PowerPoint, and either that was Cole Richardson directly behind him, I didn't have a good shot at it, or Cole Richardson's up in front of him. But there goes Walker Fowler up the FMF PowerPoint now. So he's closing in, Rodney. He is closing in. We'll see how far he is. I should have done the Johnny Gallagher trick.
Yeah, we did.
Counting him as he passed a tree to see how far behind Chris Borich is. There goes Borich.
Yeah, 20 seconds or so there. 20 seconds or so, maybe a little bit longer than that up. But it looks like that gap is closing between second and third Neal and Fowler.
I got to say, I'm shocked. I thought there would be more bottled up riders here in the afternoon ATV race, but honestly, it's been a non-issue to this point.
Well, it has been an issue in some of the other areas, maybe where we don't have the camera shots.
This is true.
But I think that the track crew recognized it early on, and especially from this morning. A lot of stuff is starting to fix itself, so to speak. And then what didn't fix itself on that first lap, maybe on the second lap, there were some changes when those leaders came back around. Not big changes, but possibly some minute changes that they may have been afforded, which might kind of wane the bottleneck opportunities for those guys, which will open up the racetrack and create this going on. Now, I have to tend to believe that I like bottlenecks.
I do, too.
I mean, from a spectator standpoint, and as a rider, it would be the most
horrible thing
in the world.
Frustrating.
And I know why you like bottlenecks.
Well, right, yeah. That's the Facebook Live show. Yeah.
Yeah, you got the bottleneck show, and you like to drink out of the bottleneck.
Right, exactly.
Too.
It goes hand in hand.
But I like the bottlenecks just simply because it changes the face of a race.
It does. That's exactly right.
And it's interesting. I mean, like I seen that one time, Paul Whibley won at Steel Creek GNCC. He took the checkers anyway, but he didn't get the win. He was the only rider that finished that lap, but they went back, believe it or not.
That's incredible.
Are we at the leaders now? Is this, let's see, where are we at? Who we got coming through here now? We just saw.
So this is the Monster Mile.
That's them.
Cole is out in front. Okay, there we go.
Cole and Bryson still nose to tail. Let's take a look here. We were at 49 when they disappeared out of sight there here in the Monster Mile. So we're looking at now there's 10 seconds going by. Waiting on Walker Fowler. Yep. 15 seconds. Here's 20 seconds. Walker's in view. Now we're going to see just exactly how far they are behind. 25 seconds now. And as Walker goes out of sight, we're going to say that is 30 seconds.
30
now.
Seconds?
30
right.
seconds
I'm
that
good
Walker Fowler is behind. Maybe but 31.
Look who's knocking at the door.
Wow, there's Chris Bortz. And Chris Bortz, there's 10.
No, I don't think that was.
No, that's – yeah, it is.
Is it?
Yeah,
okay. My eyes are playing tricks on me.
So he's only 15 seconds behind Walker Fowler right now. So Chris Bortz appears to be picking up the pace a little bit. So good news for CB fans out there. Something's got him fired up to try to reel in what's going on. And they're all closing in on the front of the pack out there, it looks like.
Well, Chris Bortz gets his eyes on Walker in an open section out here at the Penton. It is going to be on.
But, you know, again, Walker closing that gap. We're on lap three, or actually on lap four of five, so we'll be taking a white flag. At this rate right now, as we figured it out, it takes more than a 15 or 20-second lap time for them to catch up. But Walker has already, since that time, shaved about 40 seconds of time off. And we said it's – so we know he's going faster than 15 seconds a lap. on this lap anyway. He's found the speed. He's got a little more open racetrack, like you said, not the bottlenecks, not the congestion that we've seen. Things are finally starting to stretch out a little bit as these riders now have a little more open racetrack. War of attrition may be starting to take its toll on some of these guys. They may be pulling off. While, like you said, it just might be thinned out so much now between riders that we're just not getting those bottleneck opportunities presenting themselves. We're about 3.5 minutes out or so before we should expect to see these guys in at the finish line. We'll see how much more time Walker Fowler was able to make up from this monster mile section of the race course, which is at the 9.5, and I think we go to the 10.3, if I'm not mistaken.
I think you're correct, yep.
And so about a mile or so before we'll see the finish line, these riders at the finish line. And that does put us about that 3-minute mark. You know, we traditionally expect about 3 minutes a mile, depending on the speed. Today, I think the speeds are a little slower, so 3 minutes a mile might be just exactly what we're looking for to see these guys checking in. But time will tell, as we well know. And an hour and 38 minutes into this race. So if they do come in within the next 3 minutes, that's still an hour and 39 minutes. That would put them at an hour and 42 minutes.
Yep.
So they're like 3 minutes short of an official race. So that's why we got to go to that fifth race. You add 25 minutes onto that, we're going to be maybe close to that 210 mark.
Oh, yeah. And it's going to be an exhausting one. And I think maybe the only guy out there, well, not the only guy, but the guy out there that excites the most has got to be Walker.
And I have to think that Chris Borich might be excited.
Exactly.
By it. I mean,
yeah.
He is one of those riders that trains, and he trains with Chad Weenan, who is the AMA Pro ATV Motocross champ, and they train for endurance and things like that. So I wouldn't surprise me that Chris Borich is stronger at the end, like Walker Fowler will likely be. But wow, an hour and 39, working on an hour and 40 minutes into this, and still. Big things up in the air. Still, Walker Fowler's win number 50 in jeopardy. Will he be able to bring it home? If you're watching and clicking it, counting off the seconds that is closing in between those riders
yeehaw.
In the top three. Ooh, here's one of those possible, but there's not enough riders around to make it happen.
Nope.
All these guys have got to be worn out, though. Now, one thing to say about this Ohio mud, it is slick. And yeah, you say, well, mud slick, Rodney. No, yes, it is.
Oh, it's different here. It is definitely different.
It's funny. It'll be slick in some areas, and it's drying up and tacking up, and it's the stickiest mud you'll ever be around as well. And it weighs so much. And hence, that's why Josh Merritt changed helmets.
Right, exactly.
Makes perfect sense to me.
A
brilliant idea. I don't think I can't believe that it hasn't been done before.
Yeah.
And Josh Merritt is going to pioneer that one. That's going to become a norm. I don't know if the guys in two-wheel will pick up on it, but they may eventually. It could be an interesting point to watch in the future. And, you know, here's another added bonus to that. You know, if you switch helmets, if you waited until after the second lap even on a hot day, you get a fresh, dry, cool helmet.
Oh, yeah, that's got to
soak up all that
be
sweat.
Refreshing.
Yeah, I mean, that would be a great move on any given race day, in my opinion. All right, here we go. This is some of our amateur traffic coming through, I believe. Have we seen Little Ronnie Rush? Actually, Rockin' Ronnie Rush now? Check in yet? I think we may have. And John Glott. I'm interested to see about Landers and Glott in that second and third place position, whether or not they're able to close that gap up on your leader, Ronnie Rush. Here we go. We're 14 seconds away from what should be an expected lap completion. And these guys are coming in right on time, my friends. Only going to be a handful of seconds off pace. If that, they might even be a little ahead of pace. 25:37. Here comes the number 5 of Cole Richardson and the number 4 of Bryson Neal. They're literally nose to tail as they wind through the chicanes on this moto track and now head toward the finish line here at this Weisco John Penton GNCC. White flag is flying. One lap to go. It's nose-to-tail battle here at the 30th running of the Weisco John Penton GNCC. Cole Richardson and Bryson Neal in a heated battle. Will they be able to take it all the way, or will Walker Fowler bridge that gap to take win number 50? We'll have to wait and see. We're about 25 minutes away from knowing what the outcome of this race is going to be. A 25:43 for Cole Richardson, a 25:40 for Bryson Neal, and we wait. for Walker Fowler. And now we check in with Landon Wolf. What's going on, Landon?
Hey, guys. We're down here with Jared McClure. Saw you pulled in. Not the day you were looking for. Any idea what happened?
Not really sure. Had a up and down day, though. It's pretty gnarly out there. We got a lot of lappers to deal with, and they were coming into play there the last lap there I was on. But from what I can tell, just had a mechanical issue. Bike stopped on the moto track there, coming over one of the jumps. Just lucky I didn't go over the bars. So, you know, it sucks. I was trying to make up points all year, and this is only going to make it harder. But looking forward to just get back out there in New York.
Yeah, just keep plugging away. So is it the lappers, or is it the actual track out there that's rough?
No, the track is not really that rough. It's kind of rutted and deep. You got to watch your lines. But lappers could change this race dramatically at the end. I mean, it's like three or four times I got stuck with them, so we'll just have to see.
All right, guys. Thanks, Jared. We just had the first and second place come through. I think Cole Richardson has the lead still. Bryson Neal, half an inch behind him.
Well, I think we might have had a change. Correct me if I'm wrong, Adam Gordon, but I think that we just got the report that we had Bryson Neal make the pass on Cole Richardson into the number one spot now. He was only 1.1 seconds back. Hey, get this. Chris Borich is checked in the number three spot, a minute and 23 seconds back of Bryson Neal. Walker Fowler checks in 7.3 seconds behind him now.
Wow.
In fourth place position. What a day, man.
That's insane.
Walker Fowler was closing in on these guys, and we saw that Chris Borich was. And there, Jared McClure may have explained to us what could have happened there to make that happen. And both of those guys, both of the guys lost time. I'm not saying that Chris Borich has did anything super dramatic by closing in on Walker Fowler. What I'm saying, big things happened. Chris Borich was able to capitalize on it, and now he's in third place with only a seven-second lead over Walker Fowler. One lap to go. I think it's safe to say at this point, unless something happens to Richardson and or Neal, win number 50 is not going to happen here in Ohio today. We could see Bryson Neal, the real hometown boy, the literal hometown boy, not just the home state boy, but the boy that is literally
a stone's throw away,
could take a win here. And he said today, you know, it's been a long time since that win in Georgia. I need a win now to get that confidence back up.
And Borich getting fuel. So let's see.
There goes
Walker in no pit.
Walker Fowler gets back around, so Chris Borich is into the number four spot, and Walker Fowler back up to third. It was a pit stop. You got to wonder, playing it safe, I guess. Chris Borich, he must feel confident about what this last lap has to offer. And you got to take into account, remember, he was winning the race and nearly ran out of gas a few races ago, as a matter of fact. And actually, no, I'll back up into that. That's what what happened? We thought he was running out of gas. It was clogged fuel lines. What had happened his the dry brake that they put in there, it was full of dirt. They didn't get the cap back on after the pit stop, or whenever before the pit stop, they had dirt in there. So whenever they went to that second pit stop, they dumped all that dirt down into that sand, right into that gas tank. And that's why Chris Borich seemed to be running out of gas. It was starved for fuel, but he still had about a gallon and a half in the machines, what he told me.
That's insane.
Yeah.
This is insane. This John Penton race is insane. This has been exciting. So the battle between Borich and Fowler, with Borich getting around and like that, the gap spreading between second and third place, I think Jared McClure was dead on. I think these lappers, like he literally had just said right before that, starting to play a factor.
Hunter Hart in the ride, the best ride so far of his XC1 career, as the number nine now up to a fifth place position here on the final lap. He was only, he's now 2 minutes behind Walker Fowler. He's gotten around Adam McGill. Adam McGill, and of course, Adam McGill is followed in by Wesley Wolf, Marty Christofferson, Devin Feehan, and Josh Merritt, as we watch these riders traverse this Rocky Mountain mulch pile here at the 30th annual running of the Wiseco John Penton GNCC. Again, a barn burner set of plays here in southeastern Ohio. Richardson's in the Neal, only a second apart separating those two. And Neal had gotten around Cole Richardson for the lead. Chris Borich was into the number three spot. He stopped for a pit stop. Walker Fowler got back around him, and Chris just leisurely pulled back out and began laying chase once again back to Walker Fowler. Now back down in the pit area as we are looking. That is the
Hunter Hart.
That is the number nine machine. That's your fifth place ride checking in there. He's getting a pit stop, rightfully so. I don't blame him a bit. Let's see where Adam McGill is. McGill does not check in. Devin Feehan checks in now, 1:34 behind Hunter Hart. What happened to Adam McGill? So McGill is out of this one now. Wesley Wolf checks in. Wolf checks in 7th place aboard the 741. So big changes taking place there. So with that being said, wow, big changes taking place. Somebody's playing with matches because the barn's on fire, my friends, in a couple of different places. We got the battle going on now for 1st and 2nd, and a battle getting ready to wage once again between the former champ and the defending champ of Chris Borch and Walker Fowler as they roll through. And, of course, Hunter Hart back in the number 5 spot. Stick around, my friends. How's it going to end? What will happen here at the big 3-0 of the Wisecoat John Pent GNCC? Well, we're only going to find out one way. Stick around. We're back right after this.
So, it's GNCC Racing. This is Chris Borch. You're watching GNCC Racing. This is Chris Borch. You're watching GNCC live on Racer TV.
The action is just heating up, and we're just getting started. Stay with us, live action on RacerTV.com.
The 2019 Yamaha YXZ1000R sets a new standard for all sports side-by-sides. Offering increased performance and expanded drivability over a wider variety of terrain. Improved overall comfort and Yamaha proven off-road durability. There's no other side-by-side like it, not even close.
Consistent clutch feel is vital to effective starts or to confidently maneuver around obstacles on the trail. AMSOIL synthetic dirt bike oil was subjected to an extreme simulated start test. After 32 simulated race starts, AMSOIL synthetic dirt bike oil continued to deliver consistent clutch feel, and the clutch plates remained clean with no visible wear. The competitor's oil, however, allowed discoloration and significant wear after just 16 starts. AMSOIL synthetic dirt bike oil. Give your bike the protection it needs.
Grand National Cross Country, a race like no other. 2 hours of battling in the toughest conditions an ATV may ever see. And you get to watch it in the comfort of, well, wherever you want to be. Just click us right here, live on Racer TV. It's tough out here in the great outdoors. It's summertime, and things will get heated. Do you have what it takes to be part of the action? The Lucas Oil Pro Motocross Championship will put you to the test, but reward you with the thrill of a lifetime. Join the fastest motocross racers in the world as they endure the elements and the toughest racetracks in America for national championship glory. Tickets for the High Point National in Mount Morris, Pennsylvania on June 15th. Available at promotocross.com.
Speed has its price. Fortunately, it's super affordable. The Specialized Speed into Spring Sale with up to 40% off March 15th through 31st. The faster you visit your local Specialized dealer, the faster you ride.
This Racer TV broadcast is brought to you by AMSOIL, the first in synthetics.
Specialized Turbo E-Bikes. It's you, only faster. And by Rocky Mountain ATV MC. Get ready.
And welcome back to GNCC Live. Rodney Tum along with Mikey Waynes and Landon Wolf here from Millfield, Ohio, and the 30th running of the Wiseco John Fenton GNCC. A little late in the day, probably one of the latest ATV races I've ever been involved in. It's 6 o'clock, my friends. I walked out of my trailer 12 hours ago to begin this day, believe it or not. And here we are at 6 p.m. and getting ready to wrap up this race. We still got electric mountain bike racing, EPB racing.
That's right.
Also tonight, we got a few things going on. We have a memorial service for Nate Martin that's going to be taking place at Team Faith. Team Faith will also have youth activities on the starting line with the water truck water slide. That'll be happening after the conclusion of the race, I believe. And chapel services, 7 o'clock, maybe a little later tonight because of things going a little late. But lots of things going on here this evening. Lots of things going on the racetrack. Walker Fowler has regained third place position after losing that to Chris Forage. They both lost about a minute and a half of time on Cole Richardson and Bryce Neal, who continue to battle it out. Bryce Neal at last check had gotten around Cole Richardson for the lead here in this final lap. So here we are. We got Neal, Richardson, Fowler, Borch, 1, 2, and 3. Hunter Hart had moved up into the fifth place position, and tough break for the 521 of Adam McGill, who has yet to check in for lap number 4 complete. Top amateurs in the overall top 20 of what we're gunning. We've got 3 different riders from 3 different classes. We're looking at Junior A 22-plus class rider Michael McAvoy, an 18th overall. Kevin Yoho, Vet A 30-plus class rider, 19th overall. And Tom Barrett from Morrisville, New York, Senior A 40-plus class. He was 20th place overall, so we'll see what happens between those riders and who's going to be our top amateurs as far as that is concerned. And as far as XC2 class racing is concerned, it's been a heated battle in that one today as well. John Glavik Jr. has taken over the lead in
just
that class.
We spoke too soon. Wow. We counted him out too soon.
While Ronnie Rush has not checked in, he falls victim someplace on the course. Remember, he had a minute and 9 second lead over John Glotta and Drew Landers. Now Ben Kowalewski in the second, Drew Landers in third. There's got to be bottlenecks out there that is causing these shakeups out here like this, but Glotta, Kowalewski, Landers, 1, 2, and 3, and we are waiting on fourth place in the XC2 Pro-Am class to check in. Let's bump into the top 5 of some of these other classes on this final lap as we roll to the checkers. Keep an eye on the screen, Mike, if you see anything, bump, be sure and let us know. But Seth Wilson leading the College A, 16 and 20. Wow. Seth Wilson, our Peace Boy, a minute and 44 seconds over Hayden Nicholson, the 355. Tyler Swindle in third aboard the 73. Levi Joy, the 511, is fourth, and the 442 of Noah Gingler rounds out fifth place in the College A. Junior A 22-plus class, Michael McAvoy leading out of Chester, West Virginia, 3 minutes and 18 seconds over the early leader of this class, the 991 of Jeremy LaDon from Glenshaw, Pennsylvania. Alex Elioff, the 317 from Valley City, Ohio, in third. Levi Cohen from just outside the gates of Sunday Creek Raceway here in Millfield is fourth, and Josh Haney, the 36 from Upper Black Yeti, Pennsylvania, rounds out the top 5. Bet A, 30-plus class rider, 19th place overall, vying for a top amateur position again this week. The 542 of Kevin Yoho from Hopedale, Ohio. James Green, 275 from St. Mary's, West Virginia. Third place, the 807, Michael Lancaster from Morgantown, West Virginia. Fourth place, the 21, Big Papa P, back in that spot out of Shemoka, PA. And it's Chris Conklin in fifth out of Sistersville, West Virginia. Senior A class, Tom Barrett, 20th place overall, buying for top amateur overall honors, is 14 seconds ahead of Brian Shaw. Dale Pants in the 671 in third. In fourth place position, the 555 of West Stone. And looks like Mark Batson rounds out your top 5 on that 636. Now the College B, as we look at some of these B-class riders now. Is that one of our pro riders going through there? First and second going through here at this. And same order still, Bryson Neal out front, and still back in second, Cole Richardson waiting on third and fourth to check in here in a moment. We're going to continue to look at College B. We'll let you know whenever the battle comes that way. Ethan Meyer, Corey Miller are 1 and 2. The 527, Aaron Greenwell, is third in that College B class. Fourth is Caden Pine on the 832, and Keegan Walker, 929, rounds out the top 5. As we go to the Junior B class, Josh Adams out of Salersburg, PA, leading David Kite, 321, who's second, Jacob Allball, the 606, and third, Colton Kasuda is your fourth place position, right, 613, Dylan Holloway rounds out the top 5. Junior B, 22-plus class. The Vet B, 30-plus. It is Brandon Romito from Shippensburg, PA, the 351. A 2-minute, 12-second lead over Wesley Smith. Rocky Anderson now running in the number 3 spot aboard the 363. Aaron Hendershot, the 120 and 4th. And Corey Tribalcock, the 408, rounds out the top 5. Vet B. And your Senior B, 40-plus class. It's Nick Lambruno from Morgantown, West Virginia, the 582, with only a 34-second lead over Jason Limley. Dan Dakota, former ATV motocross man, the 391 in third, Robert Stevens in fourth, and it's James Flaviano, the 353, rounding out the top five in the Senior B class. That's a look at all of your amateur classes now as we check back in with our front runners. We are less than 10 minutes out now from expecting to see a checker flag. Walker Fowler still in the number 3 spot as they just came through on camera here at, I believe, what is this, the 5-mile marker, if I'm not mistaken? Oh, gosh, we're a lot further ahead than what I thought. The 9.5-mile marker is what we're looking at. So Boric is through now. That's our top 4. Waiting on Hunter Hart. Now, Hart was some 2 minutes and 16 seconds. Okay, 6.5. I was closer to right than I thought. 6.5-mile marker. I thought 9.2-mile marker was a little far. But regardless, we'd be close to the finish. But that would make for that much more excitement, there's no doubt. And I guarantee you that Cole Richardson and Bryson Neal, or Bryson Neal and Cole Richardson, are very close to that 9.2-mile marker right now as we speak. Here comes more trouble. These are the kinds of things that change the face of these races. Riders having to back down that hill. Here at the FMF PowerPoint now, at the 7.5-mile marker, there is Cole Richardson and Bryson Neal running 1 and 2 right up that hill, my friend. Still, well, looks like Cole may have gotten back around Bryson, at least for the moment. Is that not? I don't think that's Walker Fowler just yet. Walker was a minute and 20 some seconds back, a minute and a half back. So that was not Walker Fowler in third, but Walker will be checking in with us here in just a few moments. And Chris Borch, not far off the pace with him as well. So Walker Fowler, waiting on him. Again, a good solid finish and a great day for Walker Fowler. When you look at the big picture, ran in seventh place for the majority of the race, about the midway point. When everyone else started pitting, he decided he wasn't going to pit. He went from seventh place to fourth place. And, you know, we talk about mud fleas, my friends. Well, Millfield, Ohio has a lot of them, and there they are. These guys actually living in these woods until they hear the sounds of ATVs and motorcycles, and then they wake up, and those mud fleas come out to help and assist. And, well, not really, but we know the real story behind it. For those guys out, knee-deep into it, neck-deep, looks like they're all covered from head to toe in mud. And that's what happens here at Dwight's Coach John Penton GNCC. You don't have much choice in that. If you see Mikey Waynes here in just a few moments, you'll know what we're talking about. I think he might have cleaned up a little bit, but wow, it's been a hard day on everybody. But here we go. Over 2 hours into this race, we'll be at about the 2 hour and 7 minute mark when these riders check in for the checkers. And a hot day. Now, it's not a super long race, but it is just over the 2 hours. Had we not gone this extra fifth lap, we would have been short the race. It would not have been official. So we had to make it an official running, and that's why we are running this fifth lap, which will take us just over two. Now, by design and hope, we hope that 4 laps, around 30 minutes on average, will put us right at that 2 hour mark. Unfortunately, with the conditions, some of the track had to be changed, so we couldn't quite achieve what we were looking for. We got what we got. And we're making the best out of it. Sun going down over the hill. You don't see this very well. You never see this in an ATV race in GNCC. And with that, for good reason, we've never raced a GNCC race for ATVs. Bryson is now in front of Cole Richardson at the Monster Mile. We just saw him coming in. It looked like two mud monsters coming through there, just kind of tiptoeing their way through the rock section. And all of a sudden, they make the turn, and we see that Bryson Neal, the Bidwell Bullet, trying to bring it home for the Buckeye State here today. Can he do it, my friends? Just barely ahead, and about 5 minutes to checkers before we'll know. These guys have changed positions about 3 to 4 times that we have witnessed so far on this final lap of racing. They have been running nose to tail since the drop of that white flag. There's been about a second that have separated them, and now it's Bryson Neal to the advantage one more time. Still looking for Walker Fowler in that third place position, looking for Chris Borch, and waiting as well on Hunter Hart. But again, the big news, something happening to Ronnie Rush in the XC2 Pro-Am class, and that brings John Glotta, and that's Walker Fowler. And Chris Borch, nose to tail, they're somewhere in the neighborhood of still over a minute, about a minute 15, minute 20 behind your leaders of Richardson and Neal, or Neal and Richardson, I should say now. But Chris Borch may be inching his way around just to try to take him off the podium. And he's trying, obviously. I mean, he's looking to try to get into Walker's head. The only thing he's going to do is make Walker angry, I think, at this particular point, which when we roll into New York, it's going to be interesting when Walker's going to be going for win number 50 there, as he still got that set in his sights. But he don't get win number 6. And Chris Borch will still have the most wins here at the John Pinton GNCC as far as the overalls are concerned. Doesn't matter what happens between them in third and fourth place. But what matters is who comes across this line in first. And Bryson Neal, in search of his second GNCC career win. And he said this morning he needs to get a win for confidence. He wants to do it here in the hometown. Is that a quad buried? A quad buried back there in the Monster Mile. Someone just got up and walked away, left it sitting there. But as we were saying, Walker Fowler, going to be looking for win number 50 in New York. But today he's looking just to try to hang on to a third-place position. And Bryson Neal, like we say, looking for that first Ohio win. If that gets that confidence, will Walker Fowler then be able to win in New York? Will he get win number 50? As hungry as Chris Borch is after getting that win a couple of rounds ago, and of course, knowing that Walker is stepping his way closer and closer to his records, you know that Chris Borch is rising to the occasion. Will he be able to do it in New York? We've seen him ride well in New York. New York terrain seems to be Chris Borch's forte as well, so time will tell on that one. But right now, we wait with bated breath. How's it going to finish? Will Bryson Neal do it? Will Cole Richardson get his win here today? Regardless, it's a big day in the GNCC Racing Nation, celebrating our 30th GNCC here in Millfield, Ohio. Don't forget, folks, EMTB GNCC coming up. We've got EPWee Racing coming up following that, and coming up here shortly, if not already underway, we've got chapel services, or actually memorial services for Nate Martin, and we'll have chapel services coming up tonight after 7 o'clock, I would assume, as water truck water slide probably going on at this time for the youth riders or youth folks that are here with us. Lots of things going on here in Ohio, and right now big news is, will we see an Ohio rider win? And I will tell you this, I'm going to go back and I'm going to go try to pick it out. But as of 2015, Ohio had the most riders winning. I think there were 13 Ohio riders. So 15 different times so far since then, I know. Walker Fowler's won. He's an Ohio rider. So at least 15 times an Ohio rider has won the John Pinton GNCC. Will it be 16 times here today that an Ohio rider wins the John Pinton GNCC? Can Bryson Neal keep that Ohio drive alive as we roll through this one? There is the number 12, Johnny Gallagher, and right behind him, the number 11 of Josh Merritt. Those riders are running, I believe, in that 10th and 11th place position. And actually, Gallagher is around Merritt, and that's on the overall. In class, they are running 9th and 10th. John Glotta is 9th overall, leading that XC2 Pro-Am class. Again, big story there as he made up some major time, but Ronnie Rush having some problems, not checking in for this white flag lap, or at least at last check had not checked in. We're going to check in with Rockin' Ronnie right now. He has still not checked in with his fourth lap complete, so heartbreaker there for him. And about 35 seconds out from the conclusion of this race now, as our leaders are working their way toward the finish line here in Ohio. And there they are from our Yamaha live drone. The battle to the checkers is on, as it looks like, I believe, that Bryson Neal still hangs on to that number one position. And he does, and Ohio will do it. 16 years and six or 16 of the 30 years, an Ohio rider takes the win here at the Weisco John Penton GNCC. Bryson Neal brings home the glory for the Buckeye State. Back at the number two spot, Cole Richardson finishing up second. And I'll tell you, folks, a head cold and all that did not slow down the number four, Bryson Neal. When we talked to him earlier this morning, he was so stuffed up. You could see it in his eyes, but he just knew that he had to come out and he had to perform, staying in that AC as long as he could. But look at that machine steaming at the end of this race. Talk about putting these paces. That right there is simply overheating the mud packed onto that machine, but it also tells you the true test. And here comes the battle down to the wire for that third place and final podium position finish. Forge is going to try to forge. Let's see if he can make things happen. He is right there. He's pulling up. But Walker Fowler getting a fistful of that throttle is able to maintain the position. And Chris Borch is just searching for lines right now. Can't find it, can't make it happen. So it looks like in these closing moments, Walker Fowler will hold on to the final podium position to take home third place here in Ohio today. But Chris Borch finishing up in fourth. It's still king of the Weisco John Penton GNCC as he has six overall wins here throughout history. And still, what I like to say, holding that most wins title or the winningest GNCC racer here at John Penton. And he still holds that title. Walker Fowler didn't get win number 50, but what did happen? Something else big. Another Ohio rider sneaking across that finish line. I won't say sneaking. He battled the finish line, nose to tail with Cole Richardson for that win. Talk about a well-deserved win. Put himself in position early on today. He fought tooth and nail. All these riders giving everything they could afford in these unfavorable conditions. The stick, slick, tough mud of Ohio. And coupled with that, the hot temperatures, 85 plus degrees. I'm not sure, we may have reached 87 or 88. Talking about humidity in the air, it is making for certain. Okay, there we go. That's working a lot better. So it is making for things. Look at that smile. Those pearly whites shining bright and big, and rightfully so. You know, you can see. You know, Johnny Gallagher talked about it today, leaving, turning himself inside out. Folks turning themselves inside out on this track because this was going to be a demanding race course. You can see it in his eyes. I mean, not only does he come across this line beaten up from illness coming into it, but the track itself, the day-to-day, the heat, the conditions, and the competition certainly making for this to be what it is, the big 3-0 here at Weisco John Penton. I'll tell you what, we got Bryson Neal going to be talking with Mikey Wayne's coming up here in a few moments, but we're going to do that right after this. So stick around. GNCC Live continues right after this.
Consistent clutch fuel is vital to effective starts or to confidently maneuver around obstacles on the trail. AMSOIL synthetic dirt bike oil was subjected to an extreme simulated start test. After 32 simulated race starts, AMSOIL synthetic dirt bike oil continued to deliver consistent clutch feel, and the clutch plates remained clean with no visible wear. The competitor's oil, however, allowed discoloration and significant wear after just 16 starts. AMSOIL synthetic dirt bike oil. Give your bike the protection it needs.
What is your passion? Hitting the perfect line? Finding the perfect trail? Routing the perfect adventure? Or just living and breathing the moto life? Do you feel pride for a job well done after tackling a late night in the shop? Do you enjoy time spent with friends and family in the great outdoors? Spanning over three decades, one name has taken the lead for supplying the best power sport parts, accessories, and apparel to fuel your passion. One name that knows it goes beyond getting you the best prices, quickest shipping, or largest selection. One name that builds and innovates for our industry. One name that teaches, helps, and supports our fellow riders, racers, and organizations. We are Rocky Mountain ATV MC. We have transformed a team of moto enthusiasts into a powerful teaching team to ensure that you make the best purchasing decision with your hard-earned cash.
We build communities with fellow riders to provide you with all you need to make a good decision. See customer photos, reviews, Q&As, and more while you're on our easy-to-use website. Need help fast? Live chat with our specialists, email, or drop us a line. Visit us today and experience the best in OEM and aftermarket parts, accessories, apparel, and industry-leading information. We offer lightning-quick shipping, free on orders over $75, a huge inventory, free apparel exchanges both ways, and customer service that leaves all others behind. Experience one name that leads all others. Rocky Mountain ATV MC. Get ready.
This week in Yamaha history. The 2006 WISP GNCC was a banner day for Yamaha riders in the GNCC. The number four, a young Charlie Mullins, had taken the early lead in hopes of stealing the light from GNCC greats such as Juha Salminen, Glenn Kearney, Jimmy Jarrett, Paul Whibley, Nate Caney, and the legendary Barry Hawk. A muddy day in the Maryland Mountains set a challenge for all. Hawk started out in fourth, but by mid-race had caught Juha Salminen for the lead. By the race's end, Hawk had taken over the number one spot on this brutal race course and claimed the victory on his path to GNCC greatness. Then in 2007, Ohio native Charlie Mullins, who was still in search of his first ever win, took the early lead, piloting his Yamaha through all the challenges that GNCC had to offer to finally take that first GNCC career overall win. That win set the standard for this young rider as Charlie Mullins went on to capture two GNCC championships throughout his career. And that's this week in Yamaha history.
And welcome back to GNCC Live as we check out the water tower here from the property at Sunday Creek Raceway in Millfield, Ohio, as we wrap up our ATV portion of the 30th running of the Wiseco John Penton GNCC. Big day here today as we saw Bryson Neal, Ohio rider, take a win here. This is his second career win, of course, and not only that, my friends, just a big day for that Ohio rider, and win number 16 for Ohio riders in the history of this ATV racing. Cole Richardson taking second. Walker Fowler finish up in third. Chris Borch in fourth. And Hunter Hart, I believe, is maybe looking at a career best fifth in this XC1 Pro class today. Devin Fian in sixth. Wesley Wolf, Marty Christofferson, John Glotta Jr., winner of the XC2 Pro Am class in ninth. And Josh Merritt rounding out the top 10. Way to go, Josh. And what a great day here at the Wiseco John Penton GNCC. Again, unofficial results. And I know that Mikey Waynes is pretty pumped right now and looking to talk to Bryson Neal and Cole Richardson and Walker Fowler. Is wow, a lot of things happening. We set the stage on this with a lot of hype coming into this day. Walker looking for win number 50 as far as career wins go, looking for win number 6 straight here at the John Penton GNCC, and tying Chris Borch and the all-time wins here in Ohio at this particular facility. That all came up a little bit short, but gives us something to talk about and look forward to for 2020 when we make our return back here for the 31st running in, 2020. That's hard to believe that we're going to be that far ahead. Hey, looks like we got a few changes as riders checking in. Wesley Wolf in the sixth place position now as he did just check in. And let's see. All right, so let's head down to the winner's circle now with Mikey Waynes in our top three.
Well, thanks, Rodney. Yeah, down here with Bryson Neal. Bryson, man, first of all, it was a crazy battle between you and Cole Richardson today, but you captured the win. Not just the win, man, but winning in your hometown, essentially.
Oh, man, it was a heck of a day. Whenever we was watching the race, the morning unfold, I really didn't think it was going to end up being that bad. I thought it was going to tack up, and I thought we was going to see dust at the end of the race, but I tell you what, every lap it got worse and worse, and the rust was deep. And, man, Cole was riding a heck of a race. Man, I've had a head cold the last 3 days. I didn't walk the track. I stayed in a camper the entire day today, barely even went outside. And just to put in a good, solid, get a good start, man. I think I was second going into the woods, second or third. And me and Cole and Devin, we got out front, and man, we just tried to hold it. And on the last lap, I had a line saved up that was a really good one. And man, we was just held on to the end.
I know it's been weighing on your mind. It feels like an eternity ago since that win in Georgia. What does this do for your confidence moving forward into the rest of the season?
It's huge. Like my buddy Justin said, is just getting over the hump. You know, we know we got the fitness. We know we're getting faster. We got the speed. We're getting the starts now. So, trying to be consistent. Keep that machine. Keep me in the shop, turning wrenches right, and try to keep this momentum going.
Bryson, congratulations, man. There you go. Your winner here today in the overall in the XC1, Bryson Neal.
Well, I don't know that it's all sunk in just yet, but Bryson Neal won a big one here in Ohio today and keeps it all alive for Ohio riders as far as these ATV wins are concerned in the history of GNCC in Millfield. But taking a look at this facility, wow, things are tacking up. You see some wet spots out there and some sloppy spots, but this is the moto portion. Out in those woods, we saw water, standing water in some areas. We saw some really thick mud out there. And you see by the riders as they come across the finish line, and we see them out on the trail as covered as they are in the mud. This mud does not come off once it gets on you. It is a sticky, sticky situation that these guys have got going on. So it's been rough to tell who's who for the most part all day today. And that, again, all in due in part to the conditions. Wow, what a beautiful area. Look at the motorhomes and the campers here with us, but just look out just past that through the rolling hills of southeastern Ohio, Athens County, some of the most beautiful terrain that you'll ever lay eyes on in your life, not far from the Hocking Hills of Logan, Ohio, up in that area. As you can see some of those mountainous type terrain up in that region as well, off in the distance, but just a beautiful facility here in Ohio, one that, well, for right reasons, we come out here in the middle of nowhere, and why? Because that's why. Look at what we're looking at. Beauty all around surrounding us here in what used to be known as the Mecca of off-road racing, and still seems to be quite a bit for these ATV riders. Let's head on down to Mikey Waynes, who's with Cole Richardson.
Thanks, Rob. Yeah, Cole, man, the battle was on between you and Bryson today. Battling up front there is what seemed like for a very, very long, very gnarly John Penton, man. And we know not the result you wanted, settling for the second place there. But talk to us about what it took to get that done.
I think the start was key. You know, Walker had a really good start, but I think someone kind of came into him, pushed him wide. And, you know, the track, there was a lot of lines, but not a lot of good ones. And, I tried to break away there early on, and I knew, Bryson, he wasn't going to be a person I can just, you know, drop and lose. He was riding really well. I don't think we could have pushed the envelope anymore. I mean, this whole race, you know, I tried getting away, and I didn't. And then he passed me. He tried getting away, and he didn't. And I was like, well, this is going to be a long day. You know, the weather wasn't ideal for it, but it might not be a good day. We didn't win, but second podium, anything on the podium, you know, top five against all these riders is an awesome day, especially with the conditions and the heat, you know, being able to get the bike to the finish. And, I'll take a second, but, it's fuel for the fire next race.
There you go. So on to Tomahawk.
Yep.
All right, there you go. Cole Richardson taking second place here today at the Wiseco John Penton.
Yeah, I love the way those guys all look ahead and look forward to what's to come here. Again, a nice, beautiful shot from high above Sunday Creek Raceway. There's the other part of the facility, the back part of the facility. And I'll tell you, with the rains and things that came in, surprising that folks have been able to get to where they've gotten to. But fortunately, it was really dry for the most part yesterday after yesterday morning's rains. We had the facility was looking nice. And then about midnight, literally at midnight last night, the skies opened up. Probably got a half inch or better of rain over the course of the next little bit. And we woke up to some rather not so favorable Ohio conditions. But hey, they made a very favorable race and made for a very exciting day as we head down to the winner's circle once again, this time with third place finisher with Mikey Waynes, Walker Fowler.
Thanks, Rodney. Yeah, Walker, we know not the result you were looking for. That win number 50 is just a little bit further away now.
It's like 49. Everyone talks about it, and it ain't going to happen. So if we just stay hush-hush about it, that's when it'll work.
So what you're saying is it's me and Rodney's fault because, you know, we talk about it too much.
No, that's 100% on me. That's 100% on me. Just a bad day. Just it was weird. It was off. Hit the starter button, and man, them GBCs hooked up. At 12 o'clock, they're on the starting line. I looked over, I still had the whole shot. I dumped the clutch again. 12 o'clock did again, and I was like, son of a gun, this old girl's got some traction today. Going to the first corner, blow it. Going to the second corner, blow it. Going to the next corner, run up over someone's tire. End up backwards on the track. Stalled, I hit Wesley Wolf going up into the woods and ended up about seventh or eighth sideways, stuck on the hill. And it was like, man, maybe calm down. Well, that didn't work because everyone hauled ass, and I had nothing for him there. Kind of got my act together and started making a push to the front there. Just there were so many lines. A muddy track like this, should have probably ran the big tires, but it is what it is. We were all on little ones, so it was a level playing field. But like I said, I was starting to make it to the front there, and then I just had two back-to-back trees in a bad spot. Of course, I like to hit trees, but I just got cross-rutted, and the bike weighs a million pounds, and I just couldn't pick it up out of the rut. So lost a bunch of time, but I'll take third. Chris pitted the last lap, ended up kind of inheriting that position, and my not pitting on the second lap kind of gave me a bunch of spots. So I was running out of gas, but man, the old girl, we made it. So third place, I'll take it. Considering we all kind of had our heads up our rear ends today, I'll take a third.
There you go. Walker Fowler finishing third here today at the Wiseco John Penton.
Well, that was a question that we had. What was Walker Fowler's fuel mileage? We thought it was all right. It was just all right. And had it been much further than that, it may have not ended the way that it did. But Walker rolled the dice. He gambled. He got a third-place position finish out of it. Very valuable championship points. And on top of that, certainly put himself in a great position and gave us a lot of excitement as far as this John Penton GNCC is concerned. And again, just congratulations to everyone. I think as we look at this, I see that John Glotta taking the win in the XC2 Pro-Am class. He actually gets a seventh place overall position finish. We see that Josh Merritt gets a eighth place position finish overall. Johnny Gallagher, ninth place. And Marty Christofferson will round out your top 10 overall. And folks, that's going to do it. That's going to wrap it up here on a Saturday. Finally, it's a late race, 6:30. But hey, we got it in. The big 3-0 of the Wiseco John Penton GNCC. Join us tomorrow. We got two-wheel action coming here on Racer TV. On behalf of all of us, Mikey Wayne's Landon Wolf, and, of course, all the Racer TV folks, I'm Rodney Tomlin saying good day, everybody.